Take a deep breath right now. The water's rising. No place to stand up.
Hey everybody, this is Richard Sachs, your host on Lost Arts Radio, broadcasting live tonight, and it's the 15th day of August in 2015. Year's racing by. We have an incredible show tonight. I mean, I'm pretty used to it, and I even think it's incredible compared to, you know, the other incredible shows we have. This one's split into two very different sections, and I wanted to put the little bit more somber one first, so we end on a really up note. But we have to cover these things, and you know, I was just finishing writing an article on balance, because there's a really well understood feeling on the part of a lot of people who are aware of the need for constant spiritual work to get ourselves in a really good place internally, that in order to do that you have to ignore what's happening in the outside world, you know, don't be aware of the news and that sort of thing. I totally understand that, because a lot of the news, the real news anyway, is not incredibly uplifting, to say the least. But from my point of view, we need the strategic awareness of what's actually going on around us to make the best choices in how to keep ourselves in good shape so that we can actually be effective in our personal lives and some kind of contribution to the outside world. For example, if you're unaware of GMO foods, then you might be out there really enjoying GMO corn and all these other things, oblivious to what the long-term effects and even the relatively short-term effects are. And once you understand the health effects, it's not worth it for a few minutes of something tasting good, supposedly, to eat things that are going to end up seriously damaging you. So for reasons like that, and to know why not to have an EMF router in your house and to use solid wires to reduce the EMF electrosmog that you're living in for the sake of yourself and your kids and family. For that, you need to some awareness of some of the things that are, you know, not very inspiring happening in the outside world. But the idea of the balance that I was talking about is that while being aware of what is actually happening and where the negative agenda intends to go and the details of how it intends to do it so that we can take defensive measures, that does not mean that you have to react by becoming all wrapped up in anger, which is very destabilizing, or despair, depression, things like that. Eventually we find out that our mental state and our emotional state is 100% voluntary. And that may sound really strange, you know, because if you feel like there's something really bad around you happening, then your mind says automatically you have to be angry or you have to be depressed or whatever it is we're programmed for. Completely not true. You can feel exactly like you want to. And I'm not advocating zoning out or dulling your brain or, you know, using drugs or various things so that you won't be aware. I'm saying be super aware, but at the same time, hold your real internal energy on the most beautiful thing that you know of, that you can imagine, and that you can hold inside yourself, so that that's the energy that you have. A lot of people aren't even aware of energy on this level, but it's very real, and it has a massive effect on what you can actually accomplish on all the levels of your life. So if you have an issue that you're working on, whether it's chemtrails, geoengineering stuff, or GMOs, or EMF, or smart meters, or whatever, you can actually be much more effective on those levels if you learn about what I'm talking about. So we have an opportunity to do that tonight, or whatever part of the day it is where in the world, part of the world where you are listening. because we've got a pretty serious, heavy-duty thing to become aware of, and that is what we're looking at this week. There's been this series of incidents, doctors turning up dead, doctors working on natural, holistic projects that they have, experiments, demonstrations, treatments, things that they were doing. And when I first heard that, you know, there were a whole bunch of doctors that died within a short period, some clearly murdered, others not so clearly, but I think it'll come out that that was generally the case. And I thought that it was just a link that they were all natural doctors and that the medical industry, not the doctors in there who are mostly great people, but the people running and directing the industry from the top levels of the power structure, that these guys just wanted to eliminate all competition for the drug-centered medical business that uses the damaging invasive therapies. And most of the doctors don't even understand what's wrong with them. And the connection between these doctors is not what it superficially appeared to me to be initially. And it was much more specific. And it turned out that they were all working on a particular natural approach to certain diseases called GcMAF. And this is one of the most highly sensitive interviews that I've ever done with Doug's help. And for that reason, it went out within minutes of doing this interview to end up in the hands of hundreds or thousands of other people prior to this live show. So I'm sorry, but I'd rather you have a live host for a while. And most of you, I think, probably haven't heard it. And if you have heard it, it's so important, it's probably worth hearing again. And if it stays in the hands of one person, it's not a great idea for security purposes. So by now, it's everywhere. And it's a very popular recording. So what you're going to be hearing, I'll explain to you here. The doctors who died had found out that there's... I'm going to give you the real basics, and then you'll hear it again in a bit more detail in the interview. This is about a protein called GC, globulin component, I believe that stands for. It's what part of the blood it is. And it combines with vitamin D, and it brings that to certain parts of the immune system, which then can function. And without it, they can't. So they were using this natural substance. It's not a drug, from my understanding. And they were getting kids to recover from autism. They were getting people to recover from cancer. This is not acceptable to the medical industry. Now, again, I'm not talking about the good doctors who are in it. I'm talking about the directors at the top. And the worst thing that could happen for the $3 trillion a year American medical business is, what do you think? It's health. That would destroy the industry completely as it now stands, except for a little bit of accident repair work and a few other things. But for the most part, dealing with health, it would just go away. It would be irrelevant. So that's why the response had to be severe, and these doctors had to be destroyed, and not just in their reputations. These guys and women are gone. So I thought, well, we're supposed to be quiet. We're supposed to be fearful. Obviously, you know, assassins, murderers were hired to make sure this stays quiet. So instead of doing that, why don't we publicize it everywhere? Wouldn't that be a better idea? And with that in mind, oh, I have to tell you one more part. The only place in the world that we know of that was producing this life-saving natural material, I think, was in England, and it was one factory where they extracted it, and that was shut down shortly after the doctors were killed, and some nonsense excuse about sanitation, which wasn't true, and now there's no place to get it. So I thought, let's get the guy who ran the factory that produced this stuff on the air and get an inside view of what really happened here. This is a big deal, guys. So pay close attention, and remember, this is an exercise to keep your center. Do not be distressed. Do not be fearful. Do not be angry. Be focused and clear. And that way we can make our strategic decisions of what each of us needs to do. And our business is not fighting and killing like their business is. It's healing and spreading a totally different kind of energy. When we know more about what the other side is doing, we can make our decisions of how to be more effective. So we're going to interview a very brave man who incredible courage to just even come on the show. And his name is David Noakes, and he deserves everybody's appreciation and careful attention to what he says. So here's David. Let's talk to him, and I'll bring back introduction to our other guest as soon as we're done. Welcome, everybody. This is Richard Sachs broadcasting on Lost Arts Radio worldwide. I'm really glad that you're with us, and we are incredibly fortunate to be with our guest today, Mr. David Noakes, who's going to be telling us some interesting insights on the issue that we've been talking about recently, and I wrote about it on the Weekly Focus article, if you saw that, on lostartsradio.com, and that is the issue of quite a few doctors dying in different ways, mostly in the southeast part of the U.S., but not entirely, since it included our friend Dr. Gonzalez in New York and others, and I heard this morning that there may be another one. And I thought at first that what ties these people together and was of extra concern is the fact that they were all holistically oriented doctors of different kinds, MDs, chiropractors, etc. But I was incorrect in that assumption, and it's a much more specific link. And I think that our guest today is going to share more insight with us on that. So welcome, David. Thanks for being with us. I'm really glad that you had time to do this.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me. It's always good to talk.
Yeah. So why don't you tell us first, I think you've got some particular insight into this, and go back to the very beginning, your involvement, you know, how you came to be in this position, and we'll see where it goes from there.
Well, it really has very little to do with me. GcMAF was discovered by a number of scientists in 1990, so that's 25 years ago.
Okay.
And now, probably 200 scientists have written something over 120 research papers on GcMAF, peer-reviewed and published in the world's top scientific journals. So GcMAF is now a very well-understood molecule. I sort of got into it because I got very annoyed that no one was making it available to the public. And so I set up a laboratory, and we've now supplied 9,000 people through about 350 doctors and clinics. It's difficult to extract GcMAF. Very few people get it right. And we put it through 9 tests, because if you don't put it through tests, you've no idea whether you actually got GcMAF at the end. And we are very, very careful. We have brilliant scientists, and we are very careful to get it exactly right.
What are you extracting it from, since you mentioned extraction?
We can do it from blood or from colostrum.
Okay. All right, so when was it that you decided to make it available through doctors to the public?
2009, I mean, I was fighting the European Union on the grounds it's a dictatorship, and I was given the word GcMAF, researched it in Google, and thought, right, I'm going to drop the EU. The nation of Britain was abolished by the Lisbon Treaty, the EU's Lisbon Treaty, on 1st of January 2009, after 3,500 years. So I thought, well, I've lost that one, so I will try and save people's lives from cancer, one at a time.
Let's go back from to what you said a couple of sentences ago for people that may not already be oriented this way and really trying to understand. You're referring to some pretty important and deep things here, I think. So let's bring the people who have no introduction and no idea what you're talking about so they can understand it.
Right. Well, GcMAF is a molecule that all healthy people make. Okay. It has 21 brilliant effects in the body, and it stops a number of diseases, well, at least 50 that we know of so far, stops them entering the body, and one of them is cancer. But if you get weak, you know, your wife leaves you, or you get new, that may make your body weak enough that the disease can send out an enzyme called nagalase to prevent production of your own GcMAF permanently, and then that disease becomes chronic. And if it's cancer, you're dead in 5 years.
Hmm. Okay, so the enzyme called Nagalase is something that it's like a weapon used by the invaders to overcome the natural defenses of the GCMAF. Is that accurate?
That's correct. It prevents production of your body's own GCMAF.
Okay.
And GCMAF is essential. You know, your immune system doesn't work without it. It's a very, very powerful tool, GCMAF, because it has, we know now, 21 brilliant effects in the body.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. All right. And the GC, the GC becoming, GC is a protein, as I understand it. Is that correct? Before it has the MAF part attached to it.
Well, no, they're all proteins. You know, GCMAF is a human protein made by all of us if we are healthy, and therefore a human right. It's a human body part.
Okay.
But how's it made? Well, in your blood, you have GC globulin or vitamin D binding protein or GC protein, whatever you want to call it, has three names. Mm-hmm. And that is 3% of your blood.
Wow, that's a lot.
And
okay.
Yes, that's a lot. And then along comes a B cell from your immune system and takes off one of the glucose molecules attached to the GC protein molecule. And then along comes a T cell and takes off another one. And so instead of having three glucose, i.e. sugar molecules, attached to GC protein, you only have one. When you only have one molecule, that is GCMAF. And you only have billionths of a gram of GCMAF in your body. That 3% of GC protein pretty much stays as 3% of your blood. Only billionths of a gram become GCMAF.
Okay, so if I understand you, the 3%, I assume that's by weight, is that of the entire weight of the blood or just the solid cellular components of the blood?
Yeah, that's right, it's the entire weight of the blood, 3% of it.
Okay, so that stays the same. And
pretty
then,
much, so, yeah.
And then more or less, it comes back around that level, some kind of homeostatic reaction. And it creates this very tiny amount of GCMAF, which I understand stands for macrophage activating factor, correct?
Yes, that's a misnomer. I mean, when Dr. Yamamoto, PhD, got involved, he thought it did two things. He thought it activated macrophages and rebuilt your immune system. Actually, no, it does 21 things.
Okay.
Okay.
So in other words, it's not that that's wrong, it's that that's incomplete and suggests that it's only doing one thing.
Absolutely right.
Okay. Now, what's the connection in here? I'm just trying to sort out what's true and not true from what other people have been reporting. And they're talking a lot about the function and role of vitamin D in this whole equation of producing the GCMAF. What does that have to do with it?
Right, well, one of the names of GC protein is vitamin D binding protein. And GC protein and GCMAF are both part of the vitamin D binding, well, part of the vitamin D pathway in the body. And GCMAF expects your body to have normal levels of vitamin D. By normal levels, we mean 60 nanograms per milliliter. Mm-hmm. That's what most people have if they're healthy. But if you've got cancer, you've generally only got less than 20 nanograms per milliliter.
That's a really interesting correlation there. So.
Yeah, pretty well everyone.
Yeah.
99. So the GCMAF, if you add it externally, will only work at 40% of its capacity. But if you take 10,000 IU of vitamin D, bang, immediately your body acts as though it's got 60 nanograms per milliliter. And over time, you know, like a couple of months, you actually will have 60 nanograms per milliliter. But just by taking it orally, bang, that very day, your body acts as though it's got 60 nanograms per milliliter. And the GCMAF will work at 100%.
Okay, so you're saying external GcMAF put in at that level of vitamin D in the blood operates with complete efficiency.
Well, yes, you need to take GcMAF at least twice a week, and then you need to take vitamin D binding protein, vitamin D3, 10,000 IU a day, to make it work at 100%.
Okay, got it. Now, since this research and awareness has been going on for a while, it's not like some people might think that suddenly there's this big discovery. I mean, it's been a discovery for a while. What's so unusual about this present time to evoke a negative reaction from some aspect of the power structure?
Right. Well, firstly, you know, there's the 200 scientists and there's the 120 research papers. They are not affected. I mean, the understanding of GcMAF in the scientific community is concrete. You can't argue with 200 scientists. They've got it right. They all agree with each other. They know what they're doing. The reason it's become rather well known just in recently is because our labs were raided by the MHRA. And
so for people in America that don't know those initials, what does that stand for?
Well, the MHRA is Britain's FDA, Food and Drug Administration.
Okay.
They control drugs in England.
Got it. Okay.
And they are supposed to protect the British people from bad drugs. What they actually do is protect the billion-dollar profits of the big pharmaceutical companies and close down any new promising discovery like GcMAF, mm-hmm. which might be a threat to them. And in fact, the two most active directors of the MHRA are ex-GlaxoSmithKline. Mm. That's Ian Hudson, the chairman, and Gerald Heddle, the enforcement director of enforcement.
Okay, and those are the guys at the top of MHRA is what you're saying, right?
That's correct, yeah.
Okay.
So you need to go to the website mhracorrupt.st to find links to the 10 public British bodies that state that the MHRA is corrupt.
The last part of that is .st, did you say, like Sam, Tom?
That's correct.
Okay.
mhracorrupt.st, yeah.
Okay.
And you'll follow the links and you'll see how stunningly corrupt the MHRA is. In fact, it's as corrupt as the FDA is in America. So in England, we think the website, mhracorrupt.st, they think the MHRA are responsible for the deaths of 200,000 people a year here in England. On the FDA website in America, they actually admit they're responsible for 100,000 deaths a year in the USA, but actually they exclude an awful lot of stuff from that, and they're probably killing nearer 800,000 Americans a year.
Mm-hmm. That's in the interest of science for our security, though, I'm sure, right?
Sorry, in the interest of science?
Yeah, never mind. I'm being sarcastic.
Oh, yes, absolutely right. It's all done in the interest of science, but actually all they're doing is protecting the profits of a trillion-dollar pharmaceutical industry. That's all the FDA and the MHRA do.
Right. So apparently the work of these hundreds of scientists up to now has not been seen as a very big threat because they've just been left alone, right?
Well, yes. I mean, they were academia. They were researching in laboratories. They were researching on mice. They did a bit of research on humans. And they didn't upset the apple cart. But we, of course, supplied 9,000 people. And, you know, our company had 4 scientists, 7 doctors, and we wrote 32 research papers, which for a company our size in 2 years is unheard of. And the research papers that we wrote are as groundbreaking as the research papers by the other 200 GcMAF scientists. Absolutely stunning.
Okay, so that would really be irritating to the authorities who are watching out for profit margins, I assume.
Absolutely right.
Okay, so now let me just go back and clarify one thing. I'm sorry if I'm a little slow in picking this up, but I want to make sure it's correct. Normally, since the GcMAF or GcMAF is made by the body, there wouldn't be any point in putting more of it in, right? It's just that if the levels are low, as you said they often are in cancer and presumably other certain degenerative disease conditions and things like that, it's those cases where you would want to add not only GcMAF, but 10,000 units a day of vitamin D. Am I understanding that correctly?
Well, yes.
Okay. So I guess the issue that would come up when you start supplying people is that you have doctors who are aware of the previous research, and they're also aware enough perhaps to test levels of GcMAF in the blood of these patients they have. And then they said, well, even though, you know, obviously the optimum thing would be to fix everything in the body, we can interrupt the chain of destructive events by just putting in a whole bunch of GcMAF additional with vitamin D, and it may stop or reverse the entire disease process that's going on. Is that what they were trying to do and what they found?
Well, yes, that is what we found, basically.
What you found.
There are about 50 diseases that GcMAF reverses.
Okay, including some really big ones.
Yes, I mean, the biggest surprise of all was LMBBS, which is a... it's like chronic fatigue syndrome in that you can't get out of bed, you've got no energy, mm-hmm. but on top of that, you go blind at the age of 25 and you lose your kidney function at the age of 40, and your body becomes three times the size of a normal human being.
Wow. And I didn't even know about that.
Yeah, and it's 300 people have got it in England, so probably 1,500 have got it in America. And it's a very small proportion of people who've got it. But to our utter amazement, in 2 months, the two people that we had with LMBBS leapt out of bed, got university places, and now leading normal lives, and their maculas, which had degenerated in their eyes, are being rebuilt. We hope that they'll drive one day. So we went along to the British LMBBS Society, and they would like to present this at your annual meeting. And they said, you will never come to our society. You will never present it. You will never be welcome here.
Boy, that's so unfriendly. It might make you think that they had some connection to the drug industry.
Well, I think in their case, you know, they've got complete control over 300 people from whom they get revenue. They make money out of them. The last thing they want is to see them cured.
Yeah, it's a really interesting general phenomenon and principle that the worst thing that could happen to the modern version of a healthcare industry that you can imagine would be health. It would just destroy the whole business.
Absolutely right, yes. Yes.
So, All right, so that didn't go anywhere. But let me ask you just a quick question about your comment that these people became normal, that I assume got into an experiment and had that disease. Does that mean if their body gets way oversized, as I think you were saying, does it shrink back to normal size? And when you said that the macula was being rebuilt, is that synthetically and there's a way to do that?
No, GcMAF rebuilds maculas.
Oh, okay, that's better.
Yeah, one of the 21 effects of GcMAF in the body is rebuilding maculas. It also has three brilliant effects in the brain, which is why we get good results with multiple sclerosis and Parkinson's, but we haven't really had enough of either of those two to write research papers on them yet.
Right, right. Yeah, it would be nice if human-level research on those things was actually allowed or encouraged.
Yeah.
Amazing things could be discovered. Okay, so the academic research on GcMAF went on for a few years and everybody was fine and no one minded and nobody's income stream was being affected. And then you came in and really messed things up and found out not only how you could use this to help people in real life, but you found a way to produce the needed material. Is that right?
Yes, I do apologize for messing it all up.
Yeah, well, it's too late now. But so how hard was it to figure out how to extract this stuff to make it available?
Well, it was really very difficult. It took 18 months to get it right. We had to hire really brilliant scientists right at the top of their profession. And it did all work out in the end. But it's not easy. And you know, most of the other companies who've attempted it failed miserably. One guy we know got it right, and he got shut down by the FDA quick, as soon as they found out what he was doing. But he had it tested, and we had it tested as well. And he was making really good GcMAF. I mean, the one person we knew was making it really well was a company in California. They did an absolute perfect job. They had it tested at the University of Cincinnati, and we tested it as well, and they were making brilliant GcMAF. And that's the only other company that we know was making genuine GcMAF, and they got shut down by the FDA.
Was that quite a while ago or just recently?
That was in 2010.
Okay, all right. So as of recently, your company was the only source, correct?
Of genuine GcMAF, yeah.
Yeah, the one that was good. Okay.
Of genuine tested GcMAF. GcMAF tests is worthless. You don't know what you've got.
Which kind is worthless? I couldn't hear you.
GcMAF without tests.
Okay. Yeah, because it's just a claim that's not substantiated, I guess.
Exactly.
All right. So now, at the same time as it was coming up to your lab or your production facility being shut down, experiments were going on in various places. Correct. I mean, some pretty high-profile experiments in the U.S. and perhaps in other places, too. Was it just here, or were there important similar tests going on in other places?
What do you mean by experiments?
Well, for example, one of the doctors that is deceased, the first one that I heard about, was doing some tests on many hundreds of autistic kids to see if GcMAF would help them.
No, these are not experiments. Experiments were carried out by the scientists.
Okay.
The scientists carried out the experiments. The doctors acted on what the scientists proved. So Dr. Bradstreet called me in May 2011 and said, I want to use GcMAF for autism. And I said, well, it won't work. Autism's not a viral disease. And he said, well, I think it will work. So I said, all right, well, it's not a free world, but it's supposed to be, so I will send you some. 8 weeks later, he called me back very excited. He'd got some children who no longer exhibited the signs of autism. And he wrote his first research paper on it. And basically, 85% of autistic children improved on GcMAF. 15% of them appeared to be autism free. Then we came out with an improved GcMAF, and that number went up to 25%. And then finally, we started using ultrasound to open the blood-brain barrier, and then in our clinics. And then he and us were able to make 60% of autistic children recover from autism. That is to say, no one could tell they had ever had autism.
Okay. So this is what happened immediately before trouble started with this. Is that correct?
Well, yes. I mean, Dr. Bradstreet had treated about 2,000, and other doctors who we brought in and ourselves had treated another 1,500. So all in all, about 3,500 autistic kids were treated, and that was those were the results: 15%, 25%, and 60%. Eventually, in other words, we were getting better every year, and 60% eventually were having their autism eradicated.
Okay, now did this go together? Several things I want to say here at once. It seems to me that if you're observing this kind of result in a trial, that you would, your mind would be thinking at the same time, all right, what created this problem in the first place that we had to come in and fix it this way? So I'm sure, tell me if I'm wrong, that that thinking was going on, and if not, what was the theory about why this even had to happen?
Well, Dr. Bradstreet correctly identified the MMR vaccine as the cause of autism in most cases. And the MMR vaccine makes $1 billion for Merck and other companies. And the pharmaceutical industry has a plethora of websites, journalists, media people, disinformation specialists who will destroy anything that is a threat to their revenue stream. And this happened to Dr. Wakefield. Dr. Wakefield in England was the first, well, he wasn't, probably wasn't the first, but he wrote a paper stating that the MMR vaccine causes autism. So the pharmaceutical industry lobby, this multi-million pound lobby, went into production on a massive scale. Hundreds of papers, websites, journalists rubbishing Dr. Wakefield, even though he was right. Mm-hmm. And they control the General Medical Council in England, who struck him off. The Lancet Journal, who published his paper, retracted it. And 15 years later, it was conclusively proved that the evidence that the pharmaceutical industry had used to discredit Dr. Wakefield was falsified, as happens so often. But of course, the General Medical Council in England did not reinstate him as a doctor. And there have been scores of papers since that prove that the MMR vaccine is linked to autism. But possibly one of the most effective was Dr. Bradstreet, who would testify in court on behalf of parents whose children had autism, that it was the MMR vaccine that had caused it. And they would get multi-million pound payouts as a result, which made Dr. Bradstreet very unpopular with the big pharmaceutical companies. And we don't know whether the FDA was hiring assassins or whether the FDA was tipping off pharmaceutical companies on when they were going to do a raid, because every time the FDA did a raid on a alternative doctor's practice, the doctor died the next day. And that's what happened to Jeffrey Bradstreet. He was the first to be murdered.
Okay, so and just an item of interest here. When we say that the MMR vaccine was linked to autism, do we have an idea, or do you have an idea, whether it is the one or more of the toxic metals in it, or is it the combination of the viral components, or do you have any feeling for what it actually is in the vaccine that is doing this?
Well, there are a number of really quite horrible things in vaccines, mercury being the most obvious, but there are viral components which are also very damaging. So about 49 out of 50 children, it doesn't affect them, but 1 in 50, it does affect. Mm-hmm. And they will keep pumping out this MMR vaccine because it makes $1 billion a year.
Yeah. What the average person, I think, can't really grasp too well, and what becomes the major component of the camouflage of these guys putting out these damaging health products is they can't imagine somebody would knowingly, on a massive scale, sell something that they know is going to kill so many people and feel like they just go ahead and do it in spite of the full knowledge of it. I think the average person can't really digest that very well.
Well, it now appears that some pharmaceutical companies are putting nagalase into vaccines.
Yeah, so let's go back and say, again, explain what nagalase is and then why in the world they would want to do something like that.
Onagolase is the entirely destructive enzyme which prevents production of your body's own GcMAF. So if you put onagolase into a vaccine, that person will lose their GcMAF. And without GcMAF, they are very, very likely to catch 50 diseases, one of them being cancer. So by destroying their onagolase, by destroying their GcMAF with onagolase, the pharmaceutical industry is ensuring hundreds of thousands of pounds of income from chemotherapy drugs for years to come per person. Don't forget that one round of chemotherapy costs $60,000. And we met a girl from America who came to our clinic. She'd had 16 rounds of chemotherapy. So that's £840,000 in England, well over $1 million of chemotherapy. We didn't meet her for very long. Of course, she dropped dead, as you would expect, because chemotherapy is a poison.
Right. So we're gradually seeing the pieces of the puzzle fit together here. Now, when you put onagolase into a vaccine that's already, you know, one might think, designed to create these various diseases, unless you have the theory that the vaccine companies have no idea that this is happening, seems pretty unlikely to me, then the addition of onagolase to the already unbelievably toxic ingredients in the vaccines would be a giant step forward for the healthcare industry in making sure that all these diseases would be almost guaranteed to occur in many more people. And I'm assuming that the source of the onagolase would have to be extracted from either cancer cells, tumors that are taken out of people's bodies, or some other viral source. Is that true, or is there some other way to get it?
Yes, that's quite true.
Okay. All right, so we have this new discovery with this advance in the science of vaccinology, putting onagolase in addition to the formaldehyde and all the mercury and other metals and things like that. And this is supposed to create, or calculated to create, a giant raise in income to the industry. And then you're coming along and making the research not just academic anymore, but helping it to actually be demonstrated that it works in people on a large scale. Was Dr. Bradstreet the only one to be demonstrating that, or what about these other doctors? What was their involvement?
Well, we are supplying 350 doctors around the world, and doctors and clinics. We have 5 clinics of our own. So, you know, an terminal stage four cancer patients arriving, typically with 3 months to live. Mm-hmm. They're all going to die, every single one of them. Now, that's the meaning of the word terminal. And we would send 70% home recovery, which is a huge success in terminal stage 4 cancer.
Okay, so I guess they figured after they started eliminating some of the initial doctors that it would be really a lot of work to get rid of all of those, and so shutting down production would be a much more efficient move. Does that seem right?
Yes. I mean, they've got to kill 350 doctors. I don't think that quite sunk into their thick heads, but yes, that's how many they've got to kill. And yes, I mean, shutting down production would be a more effective way to go. So I won't say any more about that.
Yeah, that makes sense. So there are a lot of patients out there now and patients' families that are witnesses to how well this therapy works. Certainly not just Dr. Bradstreet's patients, but others as well.
Yes.
And it seems like there's an issue of wanting to make them as safe as possible. So it's important that this gets out to everybody in the world as fast as possible, right? I mean, I can't think of anything else to do.
Yes. I mean, Dr. Bradstreet was a leader among doctors. You know, he was the first in, and he was showing the way for other doctors.
Yeah.
Yes, it's pretty worrying now that the pharmaceutical companies have resorted to murder. Who are they going to murder next? You know, and there are a lot of quite frightened alternative practitioners in America now, mm-hmm. because they mm-hmm. wonder how long they're going to live.
Well, right, and that's exactly the what they're supposed to feel and think, and nobody's supposed to, you know, be brave enough to try this anymore. And we need to be creative enough to think of how not to have that be the outcome.
Yes. You know, how do we stop that without going to ground and hiding? We don't want to go to ground and hide. We want to save lives.
I mean, the way to stay safe, certainly that people would think of right away, is never talk about this kind of thing at all.
And, yes.
Right? And we have to... I admit that's a very attractive option, but, you know, if we do that, the future is not very good.
Absolutely right. We can't let these guys win. Yeah. Whatever it costs,
yeah.
whoever's life they take, we have to fight on.
Yeah, I think you're right. So we're not going to get it out through their major media because they're already owned by the same companies that are making the money on the killing. So
yes, I've written to a number of newspapers, and they studiously ignore everything I say.
Yeah, it's probably not even worth the effort. So what we need to think of is we need a new level of breakthrough, inspiration, creativity, something to think of. How do you reach everybody in the world without using the ordinary media?
See, the trouble is, you know, the research papers have been written. They've been peer-reviewed. They've been published in the world's top scientific journals. And, of course, newspaper journalists won't read them. They're not capable of reading a scientific journal. It is quite difficult.
Yeah.
And so they go on tittle-tattle. And the tittle-tattle they go on is fed to them by the big pharmaceutical companies. So the newspapers are always telling lies about this sort of subject, such as GcMAF.
Mm-hmm. But you're saying that a lot of them believe the lies they're telling.
Yes, that's correct.
I guess we can thank, you know, many things for that. Television, the educational system, everything that makes people unable to either think or access what used to be common sense, which would have told them right away.
Yep, that's right. People don't have much common sense anymore. But the really devastating thing is that all these research papers are out there and journalists are completely not competent to read them.
Yeah, that's the problem. So I guess we have to make use of the journalists that are out there that are not, you know, completely hypnotized yet. And there are quite a few of them. It's just that they're so disconnected. Most of them are not coordinated and don't know each other. On the destructive side, it seems like the coordination is excellent.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they've got their stuff together on the destructive side.
Yeah.
They've got armies of journalists, websites, media companies, disinformation specialists. I mean, if you post on the GcMAF Wikipedia entry, as I often do, the fact that there are 70 GcMAF research papers republished on the American National Library of Medicine alone, and I print all 70 onto the GcMAF Wikipedia page, because you're allowed to, within seconds, they've taken it down and put back the lies that GcMAF, no one knows anything about GcMAF, it's not tested, it's got no science behind it. An absolute pack of lies.
Wow, that's pretty efficient. Very impressive.
Yeah,
it's interesting because there's enough genius and intelligence, which you've demonstrated and so have other people, that the technical problems are not insurmountable. But the bigger question is whether the, what do you call it, the promotional and publicity questions can be answered. I mean, those are more challenging than figuring out all these diseases at the moment. Because I know from having been involved in so many other things along this same line that people can figure these things out, but so far they haven't figured out how to let everyone know.
Yeah.
And that's the next technical challenge, I think.
Yeah.
So So let me ask you, I mean, it's obvious how Dr. Bradstreet was involved with his direct work with the autistic kids and other doctors that you know working with cancer, but the ones who all, you know, have recently died in the U.S., including Dr. Gonzalez, who was a good friend, and other ones that we know of, how directly were they connected to the same sort of thing that Dr. Bradstreet was doing?
I think they all were, but I can't be sure because I don't know how they were supplied.
Yeah.
But I think they all were, and certainly everyone on the internet thinks they all were. You know, I'm stunned how short-sighted the pharmaceutical industries are. You know, if you go to pharmamurders.com, you'll see a list of all the doctors that the pharmaceutical industry has murdered recently. And, you know, they just don't seem to have got it through the thick heads that killing 13 isn't anything like enough. You know, there are too many people involved in GCMF. They can't do it by killing. They've closed us down, our company, Immunobiotech. They closed all our bank accounts down, left us absolutely penniless. We couldn't even buy an avocado pair between us. I mean, there are three websites that people need to look at. One is pharmamurders.com, which gives a list of the doctors who have been murdered and points out that because the FDA and the MHRA in England are both controlled by pharmaceutical companies, pharmaceutical companies control their own licensing of their own drugs. And as a result, a million people a year die of drugs that should never have been licensed. So that's pharmamurders.com. And then there's mhracorrupt.st, which deals with the MHRA in England. And then there's chemokills.info, which chemotherapy is a poison. And of course, it's murder for profit. They make $200 billion a year out of chemotherapy and probably kill a million people a year just with chemotherapy.
Yeah, I was kind of under the misconception that the medical industry is only killing about a million people a year, a lot more mild than what you're talking about. But when you add up the figures that you're mentioning, it's actually considerably higher.
Well, we reckon that the MHRA kill 200,000 a year and the FDA kill 800,000 a year. So put the two together, we reckon the pharmaceutical industries kill a million a year.
Okay, so I wasn't that far off, but you said that chemo alone is a pretty big factor, right?
Well, the chemo is actually the biggest one of all of them.
Okay. So, right at the moment, all of the good work being done with this has stopped because there's no supply anywhere, correct?
Oh, no. There are distributors out there who have quite substantial stocks of RGCMF, and it's still going out to 80 nations.
Okay, all right. So the new manufacturer has stopped for the moment, but there's enough to keep the work going for a while.
Oh, yes.
Which is really good. Wow, I'm just digesting a lot of what you said. And also, let's go back again to the question of the nagalase, not question really, the idea of the nagalase being injected. This is likely to become a much bigger problem. I suspect that nagalase is not that difficult to extract and manufacture. Not that anybody sane would want to, but let's say that that's going on. In the U.S., they're really working. There's a big push to make huge numbers of vaccines mandatory for every person alive, starting with kids. And if that happens, then obviously the damage from nagalase or whatever bad things are in there is going to get a lot more. And they probably would figure that it would get too much to be actually handled by simply offsetting it with GCMAF. So it sounds like the bigger plan for positive change would be that you would have to not only have GCMAF available for the people already suffering from vaccine damage or other disease situations, but you'd also have to avoid having everybody get the 200 new vaccines that are being prepared right now.
Yes. I mean, vaccines are wonderful because they get two hits. Firstly, they get a hit when they buy the vaccine, and you know they created the bird flu scare, and Dick Cheney made the defense secretary, what's his name, he made half a billion out of the bird flu scare. Britain spent 33 billion on this bird flu vaccine. So they get the hit at the beginning. You know, when they sell the MMR vaccine, they make a billion a year, which isn't much for them, only 1 billion. But of course, because they're poisoning these people, when they grow up and pick up the diseases that are in the vaccine, they get another hit when the people come back to them to try to be cured of the diseases. So it really is murder for profit.
Yeah, so we can expect a lot of momentum being put into keeping the expansion of the vaccine industry going based on the arithmetic that you're pointing out.
Absolutely.
Okay, well, listen, we've got a couple of minutes left. It doesn't mean we can't do more later, but I warned you that this might go by in 5 minutes, even if we did a long talk. And in those last couple of minutes, where are we? What can we tell people that's positive or that would be useful for them to know? And we can go over a couple of minutes over because of being cut off twice.
Well, firstly, stay away from vaccines. Stay away from pharmaceutical drugs, which kill far more people than recreational drugs. And lead a healthy lifestyle. Stay away from sugar, which is the only thing that cancer eats. Carbohydrates become sugar in the body, so if you have cancer, you can't have any of those either. Eat meat, fish, and vegetables. But if you don't have cancer, you don't have to worry about that too much. But that is a general diet for many, many diseases. And the government recommends 400 IU of vitamin D a day, which is completely useless. You need 10,000 IU of vitamin D a day, and you can buy that online. They'll soon stop that if they can, of course. And then you have Codex Alimentarius, which is the EU's way of closing down vitamins, making vitamins illegal. Now, of course, we only live 2 months without vitamins, and at the moment, there's enough in our food, but that's decreasing every year. We need vitamins to keep us alive, and they know that by making vitamins illegal, by banning them, they'll be able to kill enormously large amounts of us. And of course, their aim is to reduce the world population to 500 million. So that means they want to kill 6.5 billion people, because they think they need 500 million to keep the lifestyle to which they have become accustomed.
Yeah, the only part of that I would consider questionable is whether they're actually going to leave 500 million alive. I think they are looking at advances now that make that less necessary, but the general idea is certainly clear. And I think you can get so many hints from what you hear from the government and its corporate partners, such as the big campaign to let everybody know that sunlight is absolutely dangerous. It causes cancer. You should never be exposed to it. Walk around covered with sunscreen and wear dark glasses at all times. This gives you a big clue of how vital sun energy really is. And,
yes.
And you know, there are other things like that. It's pretty much, you know, a lot of the time they're giving us so much help because if they say something is deadly, it's probably essential for your life.
Yes.
If they say that it's essential, it's probably going to kill you.
Yes.
So, I mean, it's not always true. You have to check. They could make a mistake and tell the truth sometime, but it's not frequent.
I completely agree.
So, do you have an idea at this point what your best move is? I mean, I'm not talking about, you know, exposing secret things, but in general, what you're likely to move into since they're not making it possible to do your work at the moment?
Well, we've always planned to move into obesity after GcMAF, and we may well do that.
I didn't hear you say what you were moving into.
moving into obesity. Okay. I won't like that either, because of course obesity kills a lot of people. If we save those lives, they won't like us again. But there we go. Can't have everything.
Sounds likely to be just as unpopular.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Hmm. Well, you know, we want to join you in trying to make this universally available information and see where that can go in a positive direction. So maybe we can stay in touch and, you know, hold on for just a second after we're done here and we'll say goodbye during the break. But I deeply appreciate your being willing to talk to us.
Thank you very much. And let's hope we all stay safe.
Yes.
Time. I've been looking every day. I've been waiting for the sunshine. It's been coming my way. And oh, it's been coming my way. I've been dancing at a hoedown, love to chew the fat with folk. I've been sipping on the moonshine, I've been telling dirty jokes. And oh, 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 it's been coming my way. Leave him, deceive him, relieve him, me, anyway. I'm hard of hearing, believe him, the healing, it happens every day. Out a postcard, I could tell you all the news. I've been fighting off the demons, there's no way that I can lose. And oh, 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 it's been coming by.
That was Ed Roman, Coming My Way. You can get to Ed's website by going to edroman.net, edroman.net. This is Doug, the producer of the show. Please visit our website at lostartsradio.com for Richard's weekly focus articles. There's tons of other free educational resources. We also have links to all of the superb independent musicians whose music we feature on Lost Arts Radio. Our store page has tons of great natural health products on it, too. And don't forget, our brand new, fully interactive study group will be continuing Sunday night at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. We meet every week for at least an hour, and the cost is just $10. And now back to Richard.
Thank you, Doug. So that was a pretty heavy-duty interview, I thought. At least it felt like that to me. And, you know, as I said before we started it, it's an illustration of the type of balance, the very challenging balance that we need to keep if we're going to realize our true potential and try to do some good in the world. And that is strategic awareness, being willing to know even the worst of what's going on so that we're aware. And at the same time, not getting sucked into its suggested energy of despair, anger, frustration, depression, etc. You know, be aware like a general's aware. They don't collapse. A good general, when they find out who's surrounding them, they're just, you know, they've learned to be calm, evaluate things, and see what it means is the best for them to do. And that's exactly the situation that we're in. You know, with David, incredible courage on his part in being willing to talk to me on this interview. And the best thing that you guys can do is spread it everywhere if you possibly can. That's maximum security for him and everyone else involved in this whole issue. And at the same time, you know, realize that the thing that this is illustrating for us is that the main issue, you know, because people are working on all these different issues that they've chosen, whether it's vaccines or GMOs or chemtrails or EMF smart meters, whatever. Those things are important, and the work that everybody's doing is very critical, but none of those is the main issue. The main issue is that we have a small cartel of people in charge of the highest positions in government, banking, and global corporations. And they are doing these things intentionally. And as David mentioned, their goal is radical reduction of population. And they'd like apparently to do it in very unpleasant means or ways. And that's our problem. That's the main issue. And they want us to get pressured to the point of trying to do something about it by force and violence. And that would be suicide on the part of humanity to do that. That's what they hope will happen. So we are left with choices that would work that are very much more subtle, much more demanding, not in terms of violence, you know, but they're definitely real. And this is what we're looking at. So if you want to be able to even comprehend what that's about, my suggestion is get yourself in top condition in every way that you possibly can. Voraciously learn everything that you can, not memorized nonsense from the regular school system or the fake scientists or any of that nonsense, but or the regular television news. It's much more useful to know nothing about it than to listen to that stuff. Learn what you can, and then don't just learn it and memorize it. You have to act on what you learn. And you're the only one that can tell if you're doing that. So watching yourself is much more useful than watching others. Once you have strategic awareness of the situation around you, you need to put most of the rest of your attention on saying, what am I doing internally? And if you make progress in that, you start becoming conscious of thought patterns and emotional patterns. You become stronger, and then your addictions become weaker. And then you can make changes and start getting in touch with long forgotten abilities. And that's where our real possibilities of changing this around, where they're hidden. And we have the ability to access them. So that's all I'll say about that right now. But that interview with David was very significant. And we're going to find out more about this situation and the next move of the drug cartels controlling the medical industry shortly, I'm sure. And as I said in the interview, I believe, and other interviews as well, I have no plans of committing suicide. I'm not going to do that. I'm very clear that we have to each do what we can for the benefit of humanity from our own particular vantage point, wherever that is, even if it's only sharing what we feel with a friend that is working with us or anything we can do. The size of the exposure doesn't matter. It's the quality of the energy that you put out. Now, we're going to totally switch gears to a friend and inspiration of mine, Matthew Monarch. And I've been involved in the raw food movement and learning experience for many years. Matt Monarch and people like Marcus Rothkranz and other devoted raw food people that are trying to help humanity have helped me tremendously. And I've gotten a lot of inspiration from Matt. I've been watching his videos and his lectures and other things he's done for many years. And I recommend that you go visit his website at therawfoodwill.com and look for his books. And he's got a lot of great, inspiring, educational YouTube videos that are free to watch for anybody that's interested. Matt's got a really unique way of explaining things that largely comes from his depth of experience, having been a raw food person for about 20 years, I think, maybe more now, as well as his just courage in just experimenting and experiencing something to the maximum so he knows what he's talking about. And I really enjoyed, you know, the privilege of getting to talk to him. I had that come up because I ran into him at the Pure Living Expo in Sedona a little while ago. So let's listen to the talk with Matt, and then I've got some things I want to share with you after the talk's over. So here's Matt Monarch. Hey, everybody. This is Richard Sachs, broadcasting for Lost Arts Radio worldwide, and we are fortunate to be here with somebody that I've followed for a long time as a heroic field in the health issues and raw food and beyond raw food into spiritual levels that I found very inspiring. And our friend Matt Monarch is here, so welcome, Matt. We have some interesting stuff to talk about.
Hey, Richard. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Sure. I was fortunate to go to the expo in Sedona recently, and you were one of the people that I went there to see. And I thought that the talk that you gave on physical, mental, emotional, spiritual healing and how those are all tied together, how the bigger picture includes not only the dietary aspects but emotional sides and really has to be tailored by each person for what they need. I thought that was a really great presentation. It went by, you know, in minutes, even though it was, you know, on the clock pretty long. And whatever you feel tonight, I'd like to start out with something like that kind of focus and then introduce people. I have to step back and say one more thing, and that's that I like to talk to people that don't know what we're talking about. I mean, there's a lot of people in the audience that are kind of like the choir that we would preach to that are already familiar with the raw food things and the basics of natural health issues and things like that. I'd like to include and bring into the conversation the people to whom this is new, and I think there are quite a lot of those. And tell them why food issues are important and then how that ties into the other levels of healing that they really can manage in their own life and get a lot out of that.
You said food issues. You mean like people who, what are food issues? Like person that eats?
Yeah, well, the way I meant that is just why diet is so important and what it can do to you on all these different levels and how you can learn to manage your own course of healing.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I've traveled all around the world and I give talks like this all the time on how to heal disease naturally. And I've literally met thousands of people who have healed from all sorts of degenerative diseases from eating a healthier dietary lifestyle. Now, in today's day and age, there's a new norm. It's very common that as a person becomes older, they become reliant on pharmaceutical drugs. It's also very common that as a person gets older, they end up incapacitated in some way or another. For example, they need a walker to get around, a cane to get around, or they're bedridden, or they're sent to an old age home. And it's even more crazy that Alzheimer's is up 68% from 2000 to 2010. It's pretty crazy what's going on here. It's like where the human species is degrading. Where I live in Vilcabamba, Ecuador, the 90-year-olds are working in the fields with the 20-year-olds.
Mm-hmm. So you're in an environment where things are a bit more normal, in other words, right?
Yeah. I mean, it is becoming a little bit more Americanized. And, you know, the younger crowd is trying to get into the Western civilization ways. Mm-hmm. So that's why the 90-year-olds are actually outdoing the younger guys in the fields.
Right. So do you have McDonald's there and Burger King and things like that in Vilcabamba?
not in Vilcabamba, but if you go to the city 35 minutes away, then yes, it's there.
Okay. Okay. So why, you know, from the modern Western doctors, we're getting the message that food is a really minor part of staying healthy. You know, what's the reality about that?
Well, so why all of a sudden the degradation in the human species, it hasn't been till recent that the doctors were giving pharmaceutical drugs is like a new thing, like two or three generations ago. Mm-hmm. And something was introduced to the human species population 2 to 3 generations ago that's never been seen before. And that's processed foods.
Okay, and what are processed foods for people that are not clear on the distinction?
It's pretty much foods that are damaging to the human body. Now, I know there's certain health foods that are processed in certain ways. Like, for example, you can get brown rice, which is a whole food, and they can make it into pasta. This is what I wouldn't call as a processed food. It's more of like refined sugar, processed starches, trans fatty acids, all of these things that are damaging to the human body. For example, in a book written by Gary Taubes, Why We Are Sick and Fat, or Why We Are Fat, it's actually called. It's a very scientific approach, and it's really brilliant. He shows that as soon as like a third world country is introduced to refined sugars, like sugar and flour, which is processed starches, all of a sudden obesity rates skyrocket. Degenerative diseases skyrocket. They become similar to like America and the United Kingdom, how obesity and disease is just rampant.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I've heard the same thing about the culture that was studied a lot in the earlier part of the 20th century, which was the Hunzas in Pakistan, right?
Yeah.
Who are no longer detached from civilization, so to speak.
Right, right. So it's pretty blatantly obvious, I mean, to me and from what I've done, that the cause of disease are these processed foods that damage the human body. And so, ironically, I mean, it's not necessarily food that heals us. It's like raw food. Many people like go on a raw food diet in order to heal from disease. It works, but it's not the raw food that heals them. It's when you eliminate the cause of disease is when the body has the ability to heal itself. And the cause of disease is processed food. So if we want to heal, it's not about eating as many raw foods as you can, but it's to eliminate the processed foods. You can eat raw foods until you're blue in the face, but if you're still going to McDonald's every day, you're probably not going to get too far.
So I remember when chiropractic started, Dr. Palmer and his son, B.J. Palmer, they decided that there was an intelligence in the body that tended to heal it if you cooperated with it. Is that more or less what you're talking about?
Yeah, let me give you like a really easy example. Let's say you have a plant that is doing great. It's green, it's vibrant, it's alive. And then every morning you decide to destroy its roots. You dig a hole under it and you just scrape the roots. And you begin to realize that all of a sudden, the plant starts to turn yellow and it's starting to wither. Now, you've heard that, you know, certain foods can possibly make a plant turn green. But the cause of this disease of this plant is you going in and destroying the roots. And you continue to do this, any food that you give this plant is not going to go anywhere because the cause is actually hurting it, which is destroying the roots. Now, if you were to stop the cause of the disease by stop hurting the roots every morning, then all of a sudden the plant on its own, without these healing foods, is going to turn green again, become vibrant, and heal. It's like the plant just does it on its own once the cause of disease is stopped. And it's the same thing with the human body. And if you eliminate the cause, which is processed foods, then the body has this natural intelligence that you're talking about and heals itself.
Okay, so where does the other cause, which the medical people talk about all the time, come into this? What happens if you run into the wrong germ?
Well, a lot of the time, I mean, I'm not saying you can't catch a virus or something like this, but generally what happens is the body is simply trying to expel waste. And it can do this through every orifice of the body. Some people have weaknesses in certain areas. They might get strep throat. They might get bronchitis. I've heard all sorts of things happen. I've heard people who were on their deathbed all of a sudden do what the health food institutes do by doing raw food and whole foods and enemas to help remove the waste that the body is trying to eliminate. And then they have waste coming out of every orifice of their body for like weeks as they like are just getting over this. It's almost like this waste that is built up from processed foods that causes damage to the body has to be eliminated. And generally when the body is doing this and eliminating it, the doctors want you to be on their pharmaceutical drugs instead of like going through the process of getting it out. Before pharmaceutical drugs were around, a lot of the people who are older will understand what I'm talking about. But the first thing that a doctor or a nurse would do when you go to the hospital before pharmaceutical drugs were around many generations ago, it's written in old school books, is they would give the person an enema. Because what this does is it aids the process of pulling the waste out of the human body that the body's trying to expel. I always ask like the older people in my talks, like, what would your mom do or your grandma do if you got sick? What was the first thing they do? They would say it was an enema. It was just like the natural thing to do to aid that process. But what the doctors do today, instead of aiding the process of getting this waste out, they give people pharmaceutical drugs to kind of suppress it. And then you kind of add to their passive income of taking their drugs on an ongoing basis, if that makes sense.
So you're saying that sometimes what appears to be getting sick is actually something positive?
Well, it could be positive if you do the right direction, yeah, and remove that stuff. It's the body trying to eliminate waste from building up waste that we've you know, accumulated from toxins and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So yeah, yeah.
Okay, so if you had, for example, a cold or the flu, which are probably some of the most common sicknesses, in quotes, if somebody analyzed it, they'd find germs in there and blame it on the germs, right? Like a virus causing the cold or something like that.
And yeah.
You're saying the germs are secondary, I think.
Well, I'm not saying that it's not possible. Like, there's, from what I am gathering, this whole entire germ theory, like, you can't prove anything in any way, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. Like, you can't prove that a person has a germ. You can't prove that a person is detoxing and eliminating waste. There's like no way to show it that I've ever heard of. So it's almost like a logical battle that can never be finished, if you know what I mean. It's just like almost theory.
Yeah, what is it they say? Association does not prove causation.
Yeah, exactly.
Right, if you have vultures on the road eating a dead animal, they may not have killed the animal, right?
Right.
yeah, that's a complete reorientation from what not only all of us, but I think the doctors are taught too, that the germs and the viruses are the cause.
Right. I actually just did a video of an interview with this kid that was actually at the Pure Living Expo. And he had stage 4 cancer, and they gave him 6 months to live. It's been a year. He's still alive, and he's cleared the cancer completely. He started with a juice fast, and now he eats a whole foods diet void of processed foods, and he healed himself. Now, since he was a minor, the doctors were giving the mom and dad a lot of trouble because they wanted to keep him on chemo, and that almost killed him. And they had to get him off chemo, and that's the only way that he got saved. And the only and then what happened was the mom decided to quit her job to be with her dying son, and then she didn't have medical insurance anymore. So the hospitals finally just let them go because there was no money to collect.
So they were lucky to get rid of the insurance so they could escape, it sounds like, right?
Yeah, that's what happened. And then unfortunately what happened later was they've discovered, after they let him go, they discovered that the father had medical insurance and tried to pull him in that way, and they just got havoc for like months.
Wow. Was this in the U.S. or in Ecuador?
This was in the U.S. He was one of the kids. He did a talk at the event.
Wow.
The Kid Against Chemo. You could go to his Facebook page.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry I missed that. Wow. So even though he had the chemo, which I'm assuming, since chemo, basically, if you take away all the fancy wording, is putting heavy-duty poisons directly into a major vein in the body, right?
Yeah, and what happened was he almost died. He didn't finish. So they pulled him out. He was dying, and it was the first. He didn't even finish the first cycle of chemo. He was supposed to do many. So then he just decided to do a juice fast right after that, and you know, you should see the picture of him like during chemo. It was crazy.
Wow. So why do they, in a case like that, why do people start with fasting or juice fasting?
Well, for him, he couldn't get anything down, so he didn't really have any other option. And his mom had learned about this whole raw food thing and healing from disease. And, you know, the combination that the health food institutes utilize to help people heal from disease is a raw food diet, or some use cooked whole foods diet, void of processed foods. Mm-hmm. Vegetable juicing, which is the ideal way to get the body nutrients, vitamins and minerals. It's like microscopic nutrition that our bodies are starving for. And then they give enemas to keep the waste moving out of the body. And so juice fasting is just it just kind of accelerates it. It's like the more you eliminate from your intake, the more withdrawals you're going to go through, the more waste you're going to eliminate. It's a lot harder on the body. And that's why it might be recommended to do either a raw food diet, and that's still pretty hardcore. You're eliminating so much from your diet, so that's why cooked whole foods is a good option also, to be more gentle on the human body.
So it sounds like you're moving kind of along some kind of a line from what you've been eating, like maybe the standard American diet when you got sick or got these diseases, and if you move away from that, the body starts using some of that energy to do some healing. Does that seem accurate?
Yeah, absolutely. It's kind of like you detox. For example, what is detoxification? Many people don't really understand what this is. Many people think it's like you drink a juice, or you take a pill to do a detox. Oh, I heard about this cleanse. I want to do detox. That's not really what detoxification is. Detoxification happens when you eliminate something from your intake completely. For example, if someone was on drinking coffee for 20 years, and then all of a sudden they eliminate coffee cold turkey, all of a sudden they go through withdrawals. They get headaches. They get coffee headaches. They get coffee breath. They're shaking and they want their fix. This is going through withdrawals. And detoxification is just another fancy name for withdrawals. So when you're eating processed foods, it's kind of like you're eating things that are damaging to the human body. And then when you stop it, you start to go through the withdrawals of it, which gets it out of the system. We all know that if you stop drinking coffee or stop smoking cigarettes, you're going to be better because you're not putting the nicotine anymore. Now your body has to eliminate it all, and then you're going to be healthier in the long run. It's the same thing with processed foods. And if you think the coffee drinker has it bad, eliminating one food from their diet, look at the raw foodist who eliminates hundreds of foods, refined sugar, processed starches, cigarettes, alcohol, coffee all at one time. The more you eliminate, the more intense the withdrawals are going to be. And the most cleansing thing a person could do is a water fast, because you're eliminating everything from your intake but water. And it could be really intense as you go, you lie down as you go through cleansing and withdrawals. Now, a raw food diet is mainly water-based foods. An apple is 90% water. It's like going on, that's why it's called the detox diet. It's almost like going on a raw food fast, if that makes sense. And that's why it's pretty intense. And this is why 99% of the time I recommend people to do a cooked whole foods diet, which includes many items that a person could eat, such as eggs, baked potatoes, healthy animal protein that is grass-fed, like chicken, fish, turkey, brown rice pastas, beans, and the list just goes on and on. It's very easy for a person to do this, and we just got to eliminate the processed foods and go back to what we used to eat from the grounds, which are a lot of these foods that I just mentioned.
Right. Are you telling people who want to do the whole foods version to eat a certain amount of raw food with that, or mostly cooked food, or how do you explain that?
Well, absolutely. It's one key is to eat as many salads as you possibly can. It's one of the best things you can do. Salads are incredible. And I like to tell people to eat as many salads, eat as much raw food as you can with, you know, the cooked whole foods.
Okay. And the idea is that that's so much lighter than what you were eating before that suddenly your body has energy for healing?
Well, yeah. What happens is you eliminate those things. So you go through the withdrawals of all the processed foods, which comes out. And then it's almost like you're freeing space in the human body. And then it actually, you are right on that level also. This is one aspect. But also what happens is you're putting things in your body that are less damaging to the human body, and it actually takes the body less work to break down. So now the body can go to work and do other things. It has energy to go and heal the body, if that makes sense.
Yeah. So if a person is told by a doctor that they have this dangerous health condition or degenerative disease, and by the way, we're not giving medical advice here, we're just sharing information, and they're told this diagnosis, you know, that is very emotionally shocking a lot of times, and they want to try a natural approach before they start trying toxic drugs and other invasive things like that. How do they know whether the cooked whole foods diet is going to be enough of a change, or if they have to do something a little bit more extreme in their view?
Well, one of the issues with people is they don't understand this concept of why a person heals. They think like, oh, if I eat a lot of raw foods, then I could be healthy and heal. But then they continue to eat processed foods as they used to always. So they haven't eliminated the cause 100%. And if you go on a whole foods diet, you're eliminating the cause of disease. Now, if someone is like dying of cancer and they're in like stage 4 cancer, it's different for everybody. So you might want to take a more extreme approach and maybe do raw foods at that time. You know, I've met many people who have done a whole foods diet who have healed from all sorts of degenerative diseases. It's incredible. Mm. And I've also met people on a raw food diet. So it's almost like it's like a dietary lifestyle change. It's almost like you have to – everything you used to know is just like gone and out the door. And you just got to start anew and be on your new lifestyle forever. It's like a permanent change.
You know, that's an interesting comment, because when you talk about, you know, forever, at least as long as you've got any given body, that if you stay on, you know, let's say you successfully manage to be on 100% whole foods diet, cooked and raw, after a while, does that become like a new plateau that you have to stretch beyond, or else you start slipping back in some way? How does that work?
Well, what happens is when you improve your diet, you adapt on a chemical level, and then your body starts to require less food, and you actually maintain energy levels. You need less for high energy levels, and then your body adapts to your new diet and whatever you're doing. Now, a whole foods diet is the point where I say people, if you make it to the whole foods diet, it's almost like you're in the safe ground. It's like you are at the point where the food is not damaging to the human body anymore. So that means, God willing, in the long run, you won't end up reliant on pharmaceutical drugs like most people. You won't become incapacitated, God willing, in the long run, and become senile like the majority of Americans today. Mm-hmm. In my talk that I did, I talked about a transition method. And I said, as long as a person can make any type of improvement, and then as soon what happens is they evolve to require less food. Let's say they just eliminate refined sugars. They want to take it slow. They don't want to do a whole foods diet immediately. And then what happens is they evolve on a chemical level to that where they've adapted to their new diet, where they don't do refined sugars anymore, but they're still eating processed starches. And at first they felt really, really good. But then as they adapt and they evolve to their new diet, all of a sudden they become lethargic again because they're still eating processed foods, and that's damaging to the human body still. So this is a good point to eliminate processed starches or take the diet to the next level. But once you make it to the safe ground area of the whole foods diet, you don't need to go any further. However, once you evolve to a whole foods diet and you stick it to there for a while and you evolve to that, maybe you might want to take it to the next level and eliminate more of the whole foods and go closer to a raw food diet. You can evolve like that if you choose.
Okay, and why would you want to do something like that?
Go from like cooked whole foods to raw food?
Yeah, or closer to it.
Well, it's personal preference. Closer you go to the raw food diet, the less work the body has to do and the more efficient it becomes. And there's ups and downs for being on a raw food diet. And many of those downs are really difficult for people. So it's one of the main reasons, and many people don't succeed. And this is one of the main reasons why I really recommend a raw food diet. But the upside of it is you can get more focus and attention, and there's a spiritual aspect that happens on a raw food diet. It's like a laser focus, and amazing things can happen. I actually had some spiritual experiences happen to me just from simply improving my diet to a raw food diet and doing crazy amounts of cleansing at a young age. And it pretty much my third eye opened after doing a raw food diet and lots of colonics and enemas and juicing. And then I did the psyllium bentonite cleanse, where it supposedly removes the mucoid plaque. And, it was like a doorway into the spiritual.
And was this a while ago? I mean, I know that when you started, that was quite a while ago. I don't think you had a life-threatening disease, unless I don't remember right. But what made you make such a radical change and stick to it?
Well, in college, I was like president of my fraternity, and I had the hot blonde girlfriend. And at the end of my reign there, she dumped me, and I had to step down as president. It was kind of like I had a collapse. And there was a lot of confusion, and I just wasn't happy in life. And then, months and years went by. I got a job at MTV Networks, was hanging out with the guys, going to bars, picking up on girls. It's kind of something I did well at, just outgoing and would talk to people, and I would try to impress them. But I was kind of miserable on the inside, like looking for something. Mm-hmm. And so I was in the California office, and I requested to move to New York just looking for something. And I discovered raw foods from some guy that was in the New York office. And it just seemed like a step in the right direction of what I was looking for. And while this isn't what I was looking for, it was a stepping stone to what I was looking for, if that makes sense, which was all the spiritual aspects of it all. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying a raw food diet is the way to become more spiritual. It's not true at all. It's just like a doorway. Just like there's many doorways, like such as yoga, people do tapping, breathing. There's all sorts of different things that a person could do. But this is just one of the things that I stumbled upon. I was just looking for change, and I just did it.
Yeah. So was that? I mean, I'm assuming that you were on just a pretty standard diet before that. It must have been kind of a shocking change for your body, right? I mean, what was that like?
Yeah. I got a book, and I didn't even know a raw food diet existed. But then after I read this book by Norman Walker called Become Younger, I couldn't believe that refined sugars and processed starches were bad for me and other foods. And I was just reading how all these people were healing from disease and the ideal way for the body. And I just started doing it. I was excited about it. And then you begin to start feeling really, really good. When I went on the raw food diet, I felt like crap at first. I was working at MTV Networks. I didn't know what I was doing. I was running back and forth to the bathroom. I had zits on my face. I had a runny nose. But then the guy who introduced it to me, was his brother was a colon therapist, and I got a colonic. And then as soon as I did that, all of a sudden my zits went away, my runny nose went away. I felt on top of the world. And then, 2 weeks later, I'd be back in the same situation as my body went through withdrawals and detox again. So I booked another colonic. So I did this for like 8 months, like every 2 weeks. I was an extremist and I was just going all the way with it. So I was really detoxing on a cellular level, taking my body to the next level to evolve quicker to a raw food diet. And I felt incredibly good. I thought that this was what a person needed for happiness. That's like what the typical trapper raw fooder runs into. Later I learned that wasn't the case. It becomes like your everyday norm, and then you want more and more and more, and it's like, it's capped off. You can only feel so good with food and eating a certain way.
Yeah, it forces you onto other levels, I guess, right, to find more.
Right, absolutely, so which is the spiritual, yeah.
This focus on colonics and enemas, I know that it's not anything recent. This has been talked about since before there were enema bags available in the grocery store or the drugstore. And I remember, Dr. Gerson in the 1930s, who started to cure some of the terminal cancer cases, found that if he did enough enemas, they didn't even need pain pills while they were getting better. why are enemas so amazing, and why is everybody terrified of them?
It's interesting. Like, I just happen to be talking about them right now because people are terrified of them. I try to like not talk about them much because I want people to listen to me. The main thing is to first eliminate processed foods. And if you can get through that phase without the enemas, you know, that's great. And the best time to do enemas is when you're sick, when you are, that's like the ultimate time. But the reason why it's so good is it kind of like pulls the withdrawals out. It's like cheating the process. It's like kind of evolving on a chemical level at a faster rate. It's like removing waste on a cellular level. The way the body changes on a chemical level that I've been talking about all the time is pretty much as you eliminate waste from the body, this is how it enables the body to work more efficiently. It's almost like happening on a cellular level. And the colon is the way station of the human organism. And many people are probably thinking, you know, I go to the bathroom 3 times a day. I don't need colonics or enemas. And, you know, maybe you don't, but the enemas don't only pull out solid waste. It pulls out much more than that. And one thing that it pulls out, you know, is acids, dead cells, but also invisible waste matter that you can't even see with the human eye, which is gas. And many people don't realize they have, like, for example, if you were to see a person, you know, with the beer belly, you know, a lot of people have those big beer bellies. Right. If you look at that belly, that's not like solid feces that is making that belly protrude. That is gas in the human body. And so we get inundated with gas because, like, gas is a big aspect of what processed foods creates in the human body. And so we have all this invisible waste matter in our system, and it's like pushing up against the organs, even waste and acids pushing up against the organs, and it's almost like clogged on some sort of level. And what happens is when you start doing colonics, you unclog the colon, and then all of a sudden the other organs can start dumping in and your body starts working more efficiently. Sometimes people get sick when they unclog their colon because now everything just pours in after all this time. Just the other day, a few months ago, actually, my next door neighbor, his kid was sick, and he was like bedridden. He couldn't get out of bed, and he's like, "Do you have any golden seal or silver or whatever?" I'm like, "Oh man, I know that these things aren't going to be like of help." I'm like, "Just give them an enema. Give them an enema." He's like, "Ah, no, he doesn't like to do that." So all of a sudden, I start talking to the guy. I'm like, "Yeah, I'll go get you your stuff." But we started talking outside his house, and we were hanging out there. And then all of a sudden, the the kid, all of a sudden, 20 minutes later, starts running, runs outside, and is like running around with his blanket, like out of bed. And we're like, "What the heck happened?" And she's like, "I gave him an enema. This hard thing came out, and then all of a sudden, he was better."
Wow.
One other example. A housekeeper came to us. Actually, this has happened more than one time. Three of them have done that before. "Can we have $500 to give my daughter sinus surgery?" I'm like, "No." "Here's a free enema bag. Give this to her and let me know what happens." All of a sudden, her nose was clear and didn't need the sinus surgery anymore.
Yeah, wow, that's totally amazing. Somebody told me that, I didn't read this myself, but they said that it used to be in the Merck manual up to, I don't know, 1970 or something, and then it disappeared.
The what? The enemas?
Yeah.
Yeah, I haven't heard that, but yeah.
Yeah, it's true. And that was back when, you know, doctors used to actually come to your house and talk to you and stuff like that.
Right.
But, the reason that it's so amazing and why, you know, that I had mentioned that it was good instead of pain drugs sometimes. I'm not sure of the exact mechanism it does this, but, you know, it was mentioned even for cancer patients and other people with incredible pain that for some reason when they had enemas frequently enough, they could just stop the pain drugs, which was really helpful because the pain drugs themselves stopped the elimination.
Right, absolutely. And the pain has to do with being inundated with all this toxicity in the human body. And when you all of a sudden, for the first time, you start to eliminate this stuff, incredible things happen.
Right. Have you noticed that when an enema or some other means of getting the elimination started happens, sometimes sensitivity to bright light and things that go together with migraines and that sort of stuff goes away?
Yeah, I've heard of many different things happen with enemas and this type of lifestyle of eliminating processed foods. We want to eliminate processed foods, though, while doing the enemas, because if you don't eliminate the processed foods, you're still putting the stuff, the bad stuff that causes disease in the human body, and you're not going through withdrawals. It's not until you eliminate processed foods, then the enemas and colonics become even extremely more beneficial than they would have if you just did enemas without the – even though it could be extremely beneficial if you want to still eat processed foods, but the two together is the key for healing.
Yeah, because eventually I would think that total dependence on enemas would not be that great.
Yeah, absolutely not.
Hmm. Okay, so if people are trying to figure out how to tailor what they need to their particular condition, I want to give them as much of a feel for that as possible, because even if there's a great healer that people can go to, a great consultant, there are hundreds of millions of people or more that need to understand this. So it seems like there are some basics that almost everybody could start with if they don't feel as good as they want to. Is that true?
Yeah, absolutely. I do Tuesday night hangouts every week. And in order to heal, everyone's always asking me, how do I heal this? How do I heal this? They're always asking for supplements and superfoods too. But the answer is always the same. It's this process of eliminating processed foods. It works from what I've seen, you know, disclaimer here, I'm not a doctor, but I've seen it work for everything across the board.
Okay, so if you had to describe that same thing that applies to everybody, what would you say about that so people understand it?
The key is to eliminate processed foods from the human diet. We actually, let's get a little bit deeper into this concept. There's so many diets out there on the market today. I'm sure you've heard of many of them, such as the Zone Diet, the Macrobiotics Diet, the South Beach Diet, the Paleo Diet, the Maker's Diet. And the list just goes on and on and on. And the creators of these diets, they claim to get results. They say people are healing from disease and losing weight. And to be honest with you, I've seen many people do these diets and heal from disease and lose weight. And there's one common denominator on why they all succeed.
Okay.
The common denominator is they all eliminate processed foods. And the crazy thing about it is all these diets we just mentioned, they all eliminate the same exact foods, and that's why they work. Every diet out there that works, they all eliminate processed foods. That's the only reason why it works. They all just make different rules to stand out from others. These are fad diets. But the
they're trying to look like a really special diet by saying what you can eat is slightly different from the other ones, but actually they're variations of the same thing.
Right, absolutely. And a person could like say eliminate all these things and then drink your own urine or something, or play with, do crazy things, mm-hmm. and it works because they've eliminated the processed foods. You could create whatever the heck you want based off of that, if you know what I mean.
Wow, yeah.
So it's all about, the key is to eliminate processed foods. That's all you have to do. And if a person wants to like understand what whole foods are, remember at that talk I gave a whole foods list. Mm-hmm. I don't know if we could provide a link for the people here or...
Yeah, we do have that list, and I'm sure that we can do that. What I'd like to do is put a link on our website, and everybody can go there, and it'll show your list, and it'll lead to your site. I'd like it to lead maybe to the hangout that you mentioned too, if that's open to more people.
Yeah, absolutely. It's just a live hangout available to anybody.
Okay.
Yeah, and then I'll give you the link to the Whole Foods list on our website. And if you could eliminate everything from your diet but what's on this list,
mm-hmm.
which has chicken, fish, turkey, eggs, brown rice, beans, baked potatoes, goat's cheese, goat's milk, the list just goes on and on. If you could eliminate everything from your diet but what's on this list, mm-hmm. congratulations. You did it. In the long run, you have the potential to be pharmaceutical drug-free, degenerative disease-free, Walker cane-free, senile-free, God willing, of course.
So except for the people that are, some of the people are going to have probably nervous breakdowns from this diet, and those are the ones that say that you cannot eat anything but raw foods or you're going to die.
Right. Yeah. I'm not about that. This is not, it's raw foods is a very difficult task to do. This is a whole foods diet. It's more accessible to many more people. Mm-hmm. Now, and I mentioned all those foods. I mean, you could eat eggs, brown rice, beans, baked potatoes, animal protein. Like, come on. We just got to get rid of one of the most is refined sugar and bread and pastas and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Like, these are the things that are the most damaging to the body. But we've replaced those with salads and quinoa, baked potatoes. There's a lot of whole foods that man used to live off in the past before disease was rampant like this.
Yeah, yeah. And cultures I mentioned like the Hunzas did quite well on that diet.
Yeah.
Partly because they grew all of it right where they lived. I mean, that does help.
Right.
The other thing is that on whole foods, you probably want to have actual whole foods that are grown normally, not soaked with poisons, right, while they're being grown.
Yeah, that's good, to have organic if you possibly can.
Yeah. Okay, so I was going to ask you, I know with the raw food diet, it can be really emotionally difficult to stay on it. And as I think you said before, most people don't stick to it if they try it. Does this happen with the whole foods diet too? Are they going back and forth, and what's the progression there?
Well, it depends on every individual, of course, but it might be difficult, the whole foods diet. However, compared to a raw food diet, it's 100 times easier, and the success rate is a lot easier also. It's that's why I recommend it to 99% of the people. It's accessible. It's a possibility.
Right. You know, it struck me recently that the other thing that would be really valuable to be able to tell people is when you're dealing with the things that make you want to run back and have McDonald's and pizza and beer and all the stuff that you're used to, are there ways that you can work on, I don't know, your emotional strength or stability or something that's going to make it easier to voluntarily do whatever changes you want instead of feel like you have no control?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's kind of like the spiritual ball game, if you, in some sort of way.
Mm-hmm.
Generally, what happens is a person improves their diet, and then they start to go through the withdrawals and detoxification, and then they start shaking, and they like, it just gets really intense. And for a lot of people, it's almost like they become obsessed with like food. For example, they might all of a sudden get this craving for pizza, and all they could think about the pizza. There's no pizza around, and they start salivating. They smell the pizza, and there's no pizza there. And there's just nothing that you can possibly eat on your whole foods diet that is going to satisfy or quench the desire for this pizza. And it's almost like they become possessed, and then they eat the pizza.
Mm-hmm.
And what is very interesting and good about this is actually a good time to, you know, maybe do an enema, the enemas and colonics too, to help pull the withdrawals and cravings out. But regardless, this situation that you're in, to where you really want that food and you can't go anymore, let's just say you give in the first time,
mm-hmm.
that's fine and dandy. But then what many people do is, like, what happens is when a person eats that food is it stops the withdrawals. So all of a sudden they get that smile on their face. Like, it's almost like the coffee drinker who gets their fix, and all of a sudden they can stop the shaking and they're just like feeling great. And it also stimulates them. The food and the coffee stimulates the person. So it stops the detox and they're stimulated at the same time. So they're just flying and having a good time. And then they just look back and be like, you know what? Whole foods, raw foods, forget that. I'm feeling great now. But then they continue to eat their old way, and then they become lethargic again. They're like, let me try this raw food diet again. And our whole foods diet, and they go through this loop, and they don't see this understanding that's happening. So what happens is, when this happens and you give in, you want to get back on the wagon and try again. So now back to your question about tips on how to succeed at this. When you get to that point where you're feeling like that heroin addict, where you need that pizza,
right,
and you can't go any further, it's almost like, this is a time to where we could do some spiritual work and look at our reality. Our reality is everything that we experience, that we feel and go through within our body. And at this point in time, it's almost like we do focus work by kind of like looking. We get out of our mind, we like look at the feeling of this heroin addict situation. And it's almost like you begin to look at it and focus, and you begin to realize like you're starving. But wait a minute, if you're doing this focus work, you realize, wait a minute, that's just my stomach shrinking. And I have a little bit more energy right now while my stomach is shrinking. It's almost like I could get used to this feeling. And this is really trippy. My salivary glands are going and there's no pizza around. I smell pizza and there's no pizza. And you're kind of doing this focus work and you're like, wow, this is pretty cool. And then the emotional issues come at the same exact time. And if we don't like sit here and do this focus work, we're going to lose the ball game here and eat the pizza. So what we could do, it's almost like exciting when you go through these withdrawals, because it's almost like you're playing a video game and you get to the point that the farthest you've ever been before to where you generally fail. And you're sitting here like Mario trying to get past this monster and get to the next level. Mm-hmm. So what we could do is focus and look at what the pain and suffering that we're actually going through. What is controlling me in order to eat this pizza? It's almost like a chessboard game. Something is making you want to eat this pizza. And so we have to look at everything, the feelings, the vibrations, everything possible. We're in the middle of this board chessboard game, and we want to figure out why we are failing. And once we get to, we understand and start to get used to these feelings and energies and vibrations, we can actually get control over it. Like, for example, this feeling of the stomach shrinking before, that's like pain and suffering and hungry. Maybe we could just look at this and be like, whoa, I could get used to that. This is like not something. And you just like evolve. It's almost like spiritual work through focus in order to get to the next level.
Wow. I know exactly what you're talking about. I'm trying to look at that and listen to it as if I never heard anything like that before. And you're right, it is incredibly energizing and exciting once you start realizing what it is. It's like in the Matrix, it's just a program. And if you think the program is you, you can't do anything. If you think it's a program, you can change programs. But
absolutely,
if you're not used to this and you just, you know, your brain has already defined many years ago that when you get that particular feeling in your stomach that you're talking about, this means that you're hungry and starving and need pizza or whatever. How do you even begin to recalibrate and realize that that's not necessarily the truth?
Well, there's like a whole... It's not only that hungry feeling that you're up against and dealing with, but one thing is just like experiencing it and doing it and going through it over and over again until you get past that level, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. But there's more subtle things that you're dealing with also. For example, there's the feeling of insecurity, pain, suffering, that also the emotional issues are getting you to eat also. So when we do the focus work during that point where you're about to eat, where you're getting, it feels like you're possessed and you can't even control yourself, there's more than just the stomach shrinking. There are other feelings and vibrations of like helplessness, insecurity, and these are the things we need to dominate and look at with resistance and kind of like battle in some sort of aspect and understand it all, endure until it's gone. Be excited that, you know, this is an opportunity to get past this level and never be subject to this again.
So when you talk about the term focus work, without, you know, having the time to give another 10-hour class in it right now, can you give people some hints on how they could start playing with that and get a feel for what it actually means and all the things it could apply to?
Yeah, absolutely. Some people like to consider it meditation, where this focus work, and it could be called meditation, but there's certain things we got to watch out for with meditation also, that I sometimes talk about, but we could talk about that in a little bit. But real quickly, just a real quick thing on this focus work. We are human beings. We are here on Earth, and you know, things happen. For example, maybe you're in a bad relationship. Maybe you're not being treated well and you're being cheated on. Or maybe you have a family member or a friend who's walking all over your boundaries. For example, maybe they come over unannounced. They walk in your house without knocking. They sit on your couch. They eat your food without asking. And it doesn't really feel too good. Or maybe you've been physically abused or emotionally abused. Or maybe you're always suffering because you think you're too skinny or too overweight. Regardless of what it is, many of us are suffering on a spiritual level and are in pain. And what happens generally is, you know, we go to work 8 hours, we're doing our work, and then we come home and we don't want to look at that garbage that we're suffering from. So what we'll do is we'll watch TV or go on Facebook. And it's okay to watch TV and go on Facebook, but it's really good to take out some time to actually do some of this spiritual work, if that makes sense. So this ow that we're, it's like almost like an ow feeling that we're avoiding. We never want to look at it. We want to be in other realities, such as the Facebook world or the TV world or something like this. So if we can start doing focus, which takes us out of like other realities and brings us into our own, we can actually try to heal and get rid of the suffering that we're experiencing. And many people might be like, hey, I'm not suffering. What are you talking about? I mean, let me just give you an example. Many of us, you know, this has happened many times where you're driving all alone by yourself. Nobody else is around in your car and you're driving and you're just looking out the window and you're like, oh, this sucks. Life just sucks right now. You're changing the radio station. Before, you were listening to a song. You were dancing, but now just nothing helps. Even the same song comes on, you're just miserable. Many people know what I'm talking about now, and you just sulk. This is actually another good situation to actually like do the work, and this is like what focus work is. And when we start to focus, we can kind of come out of our mind. And generally what happens is when we're sitting there in the car miserable, we're kind of like thinking in our mind, how can we make our life better? How can we make our life better? This is what we're trying to do. We're trying to, through thoughts, logical thoughts, of how we can improve our lives so we're not in misery. But misery is a feeling. You can't improve it with thoughts. And the misery can't even be seen unless you focus and get out of your mind in these thoughts. And then the first thing that we want to do is do this focus work, meditation, whatever you want to call it, and identify the ow that is making us suffer on a spiritual level. This isn't like a physical ow, like a cut. It's more of like a spiritual ow. It's even more painful. This is like the emotional garbage or whatever you want to look at it as. And then what we do is we identify this ow, and then the goal is to get it out of our reality so we don't have it there anymore. And the number one spiritual weapon that a human being has is our focus. It's almost like a laser beam. And so we have to discover through doing different things on how to get this ow out. And the way to do this is we have to figure it out. It's like a chessboard game. It's different for everything. What you might have to like, first thing is to identify the ow, so then you could work on it. Maybe you have to stare at it with like resistance. Maybe you have to look at it without, maybe you have to not look at it, but look at it at the same time. Or maybe you have to say no to it, or you have to figure out. And there's so many different vibrations and frequencies. It's almost like a chessboard game. We've got to figure out what we need to do on a spiritual level to remove it. And this is like all the spiritual focus game. And then once you get it out, or when you start to work on this, you'll begin to notice that you experience less and less, less of this, and you suffer less, and you become more free and healthy on a spiritual, physical level.
Mm. Well, I love it. There's so many paradoxes that have to become okay, the first one of which may be that if you're not willing to look at it or experience it, it's probably not going to get better.
Right, or like identify it, absolutely, yeah. Like exactly. And then the goal, like if you just like let it sit there, absolutely. We got to figure out why are we unhappy, and then the goal is to get it out, absolutely.
Yeah, it's kind of like the drug system of your emotions, where instead of allowing yourself to feel it, which is the only way to, like you say, to identify it, we want to cover it up with a drug of a really great movie where nobody needs to take enemas and everybody feels great, eating whatever they want to eat or killing people or whatever.
Right.
Everything's fine.
Yeah.
So, wow. So it's almost like the physical healing can't just be by itself. It has to go with the emotional healing at the same time. Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you want, I can give this entire placebo example of...
Yeah.
I mean, it's almost like the spiritual aspects is more important than the physical on some sort of level. Let's talk about the placebo effect real quick. Mm-hmm. We all know what the placebo is generally. For example, a person generally heals from disease or some sort of ailment by taking a pill that is just filled with sugar without any active ingredients. And we all know that the placebo effect works because based on the belief that we actually took something that will heal us. And the placebo can be so powerful that it can work on many different things. There was actually an example of a knee surgeon who was the best in the sports industry, had an 80% success rate on healing knees. And he agreed to take part in this placebo test where 50% got the real surgery and the other 50% didn't get any surgery. And the placebo people, what they did was they put a TV screen on and they were watching somebody else's surgery thinking that it was happening, but all he did was slit the knee and sew it back up and did no other work on that knee. And 80% of the people healed based on the belief that they got that knee surgery. So he began to realize that his work was useless because 80% of the people he gave the surgery to also healed. There was no difference. So he had to actually quit his job. Wow. Now, the danger of the placebo effect is that it could actually work against us also. For example, let's say you go to the hospital and they tell you you have 6 months to live. Guess what? Most people usually believe that. They go through panic. They go into chemo, and then generally they die within 6 months. Let's say you go to the hospital, and you get your blood tested, and your thyroid levels are off. And then all of a sudden, the doctor says, you have a thyroid issue. You go through panic. Oh, my God, this is my new disease. You live with that for the rest of your life as you serve their passive income with drugs that they're giving you. It's almost like a spiritual attack on your life. And if you panic and accept it, you know, it could be it's dangerous. And let's give an example real quick. Tony Robbins, who, you know, is really famous, an extremely healthy, successful guy, at the age in his early 20s, he was diagnosed with a tumor on his pituitary gland, and he had irregular growth. That's why he's so big. And they told him it's not looking good. You know, he's probably going to need surgery, and he might not live or whatever. And you know what he did? He says, no, I don't accept that. And he got 100 different doctors' opinions. He didn't accept the spiritual attack on his life. To this day, he still has this tumor in his brain. Does this look like a man who has cancer?
He looks pretty healthy.
Right. So, like, why isn't this guy, like, most people wouldn't end up like that? And a quick thing about the placebo effect is, why does it work? Science doesn't even know. It's because it's impossible to figure out. This is the conclusion they've come to. A person goes into flight or fright mode when they are sick. And then what happens is they get the placebo, and then they're out of the flight or fright mode, so all of a sudden they have the ability to heal. Okay? Many people are in flight or fright at work, stressed all the time, and not everybody has disease. Like, what's the difference here? And for example, a person might have 3 ailments. Okay, let's say the placebo effect works because maybe you are dripping more adrenaline poison into your bloodstream because of stress or whatever. And then all of a sudden you decide you take the placebo and you could go into a relaxation state and there's less toxins going in your bloodstream. Okay, so this is going to heal the body that science says or whatever? No, it's not the case, because if a person has 3 different ailments and they take a placebo for one of them, they're only going to heal from that one disease and not the other two. Why aren't they healing from everything? Because there's less toxins. It doesn't make logical sense. They don't know why it works. And the reason why it works, there's a reality that is just as real as this physical reality, but it can't be seen with the human eye, and that's the spiritual reality. And the things that are happening here is what's taking place that is making that is what is happening. And this focus work that I'm talking about is kind of like a how to succeed in doing this and healing spiritually. And in shamanistic traditions, what they say is, if there is an opening, foreign things can kind of like attach and drain energy. So if a person all of a sudden goes in and they think they have a thyroid issue, they go through a panic. In shamanistic traditions, they're saying an opening's happening, and now they're being drained through their – you see what I'm saying? So what could be happening here is on a spiritual level. And this is why the focus work is pretty critical in order to heal and figure all this out. And if you do the placebo, it's almost like an immediate belief that you have healed. It's almost like doing the placebo effect unconsciously. It's almost like doing the spiritual work unconsciously is what I mean.
So there's a negative placebo effect and a positive placebo effect, right?
That's what I'm saying, yes.
And yeah, I totally agree with you. And most of the time, I mean, for some people, it's the doctor telling them they're going to die, but for most people, most of the billions of people on Earth, I think it's us telling ourselves something, isn't it?
That what? What do you mean?
Well, let's say that everybody all the time is under the influence of either a positive or a negative combination of placebo effects that they themselves are making.
Right.
Means that they're changing. Well, first of all, realizing that you're even doing that to yourself, and it's not just your normal thought, it's the thought that you're putting in for whatever subconscious reason might exist, that's changeable.
Yes, absolutely. Yes. Like, it's like, yes, I mean, there's a lot to it, of course.
Yeah. Okay, so, wow. I mean, this means that virtually anything that is happening to your body or any other part of your life is probably heavily under the influence of some kind of a self-generated placebo effect. Would you agree with that?
Yes. It's almost like you're allowing it to happen. You have an opening to where something can impact you in a negative way to cause sickness or disease or whatever.
Okay, and so one kind of placebo effect comes from yourself all the time, and I guess we're always doing that. You can't not do it. You're either doing it positively or negatively. And then in addition to that, there's the thoughts and words that everybody else is giving you about what's going to happen to you or who you are, etc.
Right, and this is like your reality in your life, and you can either accept it or not accept it.
It's all voluntary. In other words, no matter what happens around you, how you feel in response is completely up to us, I guess, right?
Yeah, absolutely. But most people don't, you know, most people succumb to the hospital and they end up with these diseases. That's why everyone's on pharmaceutical drugs. I mean, that's why people are dying in 6 months. That's why this kid healed from stage four cancer. He said no, like I don't accept that, and he like took off.
Yeah. Once in a while you get some spectacular example which could potentially wake everybody up that they could do the same thing.
Absolutely.
This is also related to something I've noticed, not just in the raw food movement, but all kinds of health related things and really beautiful gardening approaches and other stuff like that. And that's that people are involved in some kind of a very positive, idealistic thing, but if anybody disagrees with them, there's this massive, terrible energy directed at them, and they're talking about love and harmony and having terrible thoughts about anybody that disagrees. This is like throwing around really powerful negative placebos, right?
Yeah, a lot of people, let's talk about good versus bad, positive versus negative real quick. Many people, we all know to do good things. For example, we're not going to kill someone or, steal or cheat on our wife or whatever, because, first of all, we can get caught and we go to jail and I can be labeled as a bad person. But there's a whole nother aspect of good versus bad that happens on the inside that nobody else sees, like you and, of course, another, which I consider to be, the creator or whatever. And so these are things like, for example, you may say you're like what you're saying. This person might be all about good and harmony, but on the inside, they're really about greed, fame, and money. Or to go for a really extreme example, maybe there's a person who's married, like you're a female or a guy, and then all of a sudden you get this compliment on the road and your hormones start to get, you start to get flustered because this is just like a natural reaction of the body. We could do one of two things. We can do this focus work and kind of just like stop this, kind of like we would stop anger in its tracks, or we could partake, start fantasizing about it, looping the thought in our head over and over and over again, and start feeling the tingly vibrations of it all and all that stuff. Those tingly vibrations that we are feeling and experiencing, these frills that we consider like the peak perks of life, is actually giving our energy away. It's almost like our energy is being drained and we have less spiritual energy to utilize at those times when we're in our car miserable. And these are like anything that's not peace, that things that we are experiencing, such as this greed or fame, it can actually take our energy away, and we get stuck in these loops, if that makes sense. So absolutely, with what you're saying, in terms of it's all about like a person's intent. They could say they're all about good and harmony, but what's really going on the inside and on a spiritual level, that's like what's really going on here.
Mm-hmm.
It's more real than this false stuff that people are saying about good and harmony.
Yeah. So what we're considering the real world is the very surface, superficial part of what's really there.
Yeah.
Right. I've noticed that it seems to increase a person's chances of success at whatever upgrades they're trying to make in their life if they have genuine good wishes for everybody else, no matter what everybody's doing. Have you noticed that to be true?
If someone has good intent and wishes well on people, that's like
Instead of wishing, you know, that the people that disagree with them have some terrible thing happen to them, or, you know, not that they'd say that, but I've noticed that in many, you know, healing orientations and people outwardly trying to do really good things, it's that it's all peace and harmony as long as you agree, but everybody else is on the bad side.
Right. You're definitely on the right track there. It's one of the most critical things we got to do is like work on our intent. And if a person who has good intent, who is doing like all their power to like really do good, mm-hmm. that's like critical. Like these, like you're talking about, if a person can accept for the fact that, you know, wish well on everybody, you know, that's good intent, right? But what's really happening with most people underneath, you know, like how do you tell? A lot of people can, through intuition, can tell without a doubt.
Yeah. Part of it is tuning into your natural abilities to sense things that have been covered up and turned off, and we're using drugs in various forms, like, you know, like you said about movies and eating things to just kind of zone out and not have to feel things. And it seems like if you want those abilities back, those senses back, if they start out by having to feel things that you don't want to deal with, you have to be willing to go through that stage, right, to get to use them for the good part.
Yeah, absolutely. And, for example, someone could do an act, and then someone can do the exact same act and have a different intent. It's all about the intent of what's going on. For example, me and my daughter and my wife were eating when she was 2 years old. The dogs came up. She took my food and fed the dogs that I was eating at lunch. I was like, oh, that was my food. You just gave it to the dog. Right. But if someone else were to come up to me and take my food and throw it on the floor and give me this evil look in my face, you know, that's my daughter had good intent while this guy had evil intent, if that makes sense, or bad intent.
Yeah. Yeah, I've noticed somebody can come up and say hello, and you could feel really great or feel like, you know, you were just stabbed or something, and the energy's
exactly powerful. exactly.
So it's almost like if you're going to heal yourself, you can't just do it on one level and expect it to work,
right? And I could the number one thing that we can do in order to heal and for spiritual growth, I'm going to share with you if a person does this, they have the potential to move eons, decades, lifetimes beyond further than they've ever possibly imagined spiritually. This one thing that I'm about to share with you. Mm-hmm. It's the number one thing a person could do for spiritual growth. And it's this. It's kind of like looking up, some people call it the creator of all living things. Some people call it the source. Some people call it the highest spirit of all. Some people call it God. Some people call it the creator. I'll just, for this interview, I'll just call it him the creator, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
But the number one thing that a person can do for spiritual growth is be like, look up at him and be like, wow, from this moment, up until now, I was doing this, this, and this. I had no idea that you were watching every last thing that I did. I had no idea that the things that I were doing was actually impacting my spiritual growth. Mm-hmm. I am sorry. I am sorry. I had no idea. Sorry. From this moment forward, I am going to do this, this, and this. I'm going to follow your ways, be good, have a good intent. I'm going to do everything in my power to do this, this, and this. I am going to prove it to you. Watch, you are going to see. Please consider me to move forward spiritually in the most gentle and easy way possible. And if a person does this, this is the number one thing a person could do for spiritual growth. And we can't do this on our own. This is like getting backing by like the highest power, but then we got to seriously perform and mean it and do this thing. This is like the number one thing.
Hmm. Well, I think that might be the most important thing, although everything else is important. But of all the things we've talked about tonight, that's probably, it seems like, the most significant one, because otherwise it's just, you know, it's almost like your ego's playing around in different ways, no matter whether what you're saying is true or not. If you're just using it as a way to cover up being aware of things, then it's kind of hollow and superficial. But what it's absolutely like what you're talking about is the antidote to that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it still might be, depending on who we are and what we've done in the past, it still could be difficult on what we have to do in the future, you know. However, it could be a lot, lot easier if you do this. And some of us have an easier path because of what we've done in the past. Mm-hmm. And it not as bad as what others have done. And it's, for some, it's as simply as making this commitment and choosing to move forward, and then like, boom.
Yeah, and I know, you know, it, on the changing the diet, you have to go through, you know, reevaluating what it means when your stomach contracts. But when you're doing what you're talking about now, you've got to be willing to relax into sometimes some pain that's a lot harder than the stomach contracting, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Because when you start becoming aware, you know, maybe you're carrying around this image that, well, really everything you've always done your whole life is really good, and everything was everybody else's fault or circumstances, right, or bad luck. And then you start becoming aware that, oh, I actually did these things that really hurt other people, whether it was, you know, some really uncaring remark that devastated somebody, or not paying attention, or physically doing something that ended up really damaging other people you care about or should have cared about. You start realizing that was you, that can be really uncomfortable.
Yeah, absolutely, that you allowed something like that to happen. And you know what, that like, you know what's interesting about like what you're saying right now is we actually do things almost like unconsciously and by accident on some sort of level. There's certain things that, you know, I'll share right now that are very unfathomable to us to understand on this kind of level. And one example is like, not all thoughts are our own. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people are like, wait a minute, how can not all thoughts be our own? That's crazy. And so, you know, if we accidentally did something to another person, maybe like one of these thoughts that are on our own provoked us on some sort of level. But how can this be? Let me give you an example. Let's say you're all by yourself at your house cleaning or whatever, and you're not focusing the best you possibly can. And then all of a sudden you get this strong desire, urge, and thought to take the scissors and stab the dog. Now, this isn't obviously something we want to act upon, and most of us wouldn't, of course. But these things come through us on some sort of level, and we kind of like stop it. This is kind of like the spiritual work. And these foreign thoughts are not just like a whisper in the ear. It's almost like a six-dimensional experience. It's not just a whisper in the ear, but it's also like an urge, a vibration, a feeling to where you actually believe it's yourself of doing this, even though you stop it when it's not yourself. It's foreign. And this is one of the main reasons why we've got to work on our intent. It's critical to work on our intent because these foreign thoughts are trying – like you're all about good and helping people. And then the desire for greed and fame comes in, and you got to be like, no, I'm all about helping people. This is working on our intent. And the reason why for all this resistance is kind of to train us to be righteous on some sort of level. And another trap that many people fall into is you take this new path, like you've chosen what we were just talking about. I'm going to do this, this, and this in the future. And then all of a sudden, this six-dimensional experience of this thought comes in that you just actually thought of something evil. And then you all of a sudden go into insecurity, like you screwed up. And then you go into loops of insecurity, and you're kind of like spiraling down, and you don't feel what this ow feeling that you're going through right now is kind of like our energy being drained at that moment in time. But what he sees is not these foreign thoughts, but our heart and intent on how hard we are trying. It's a good time to like say sorry and pick yourself back up again and try again, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. And I think that's also tied into the issue of when you realize that you have done things you wish you hadn't that have been not good for yourself and other people. How do you avoid the natural urge from another program that goes with that to just internally beat yourself up indefinitely over that instead of learn what you need to learn?
It's kind of this, it's doing the focus work. I like to use the example of anger. For example, all of a sudden you get angry. And then if you do the focus work, you can stop the anger at a pretty rapid pace. And if you start going into insecurity and spiraling down, we can do the same thing through that focus work and focusing on how to stop that. And then also there's the whole point of, connecting to the creator in order to get help. It's almost like the focus work is like there's more things going on at one time. You could be doing this focus work, but also you could be connecting to the highest power of all, the creator, at the same time and getting support and energy to help you through it.
Yeah, I like that. Another thing I've found that sometimes really helps is if your mind starts running one of these destructive programs that you were just describing that you can easily think is your own thought, if you remember that that's the mind, it's not you, they're not the same thing, and the mind is just running a program that it's been trained for, that you can actually, instead of trying to resist the mind and fight it, which doesn't work in my experience, you can offer it the enjoyment of trying a different line of thought that's actually constructive, and like a little kid that you're taking care of and getting it interested in a new game and it forgets about, you know, throwing a tantrum.
Yeah, absolutely. It's almost like you're sitting there and you're wanting to improve your diet, and then you just have no energy, all this pressure of foreign thoughts are coming on you. And it sounds like these foreign thoughts are saying, you can't do this, I can't do this, I can't do this, I can't do this. But what you have is your true being, and you can actually say, like a good trained thought of like what you're saying, this is your gift, this is your free will. You can say, no, I am healthy, I am able to do this without a problem. It's almost like battling the foreign thoughts. And it's almost like the spiritual world is almost like a cobweb of just madness out there. And not all madness, but it's just a cobweb. And so things that you are hearing and seeing are not necessarily always your mind, but many of us could think it's our mind. It's foreign thoughts.
Yeah, I have to respond to that with one more thing that's going to make maybe a lot of people think that I'm completely, you know, I've lost it, you know. But what strikes me, it's just like you said, placebos can be good or bad, right? They can be constructive or negative. I have found that foreign thoughts can be the same way, and that we have one of our capabilities that most of us are not too conscious of is the ability to tune the dial like our radio receiver to what you want to pick up. And if you know if we're used to tuning it to negative, destructive thoughts and then thinking they're our own, even though they're foreign, well, we could do that a different way too and pick up some thoughts that are not our own that are even more positive than we could otherwise by ourselves imagine, and start letting those in. And they're out there in amazing levels that might, you know, short circuit the progress in that direction if we allow them to come in.
Cool.
So you want to have me hauled away, or what do you think?
I personally like I don't like any thoughts besides my own, if that makes sense.
Oh, that's fine.
Yeah.
And it's all levels of you anyway. I mean, I suspect there are levels of you that are so, you know, far advanced of what we're aware of now that if you become receptive to those are your own thoughts.
Yeah, there's so much out there that I don't know. I don't even know, like, what is going on. Like, I know very little, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So the big picture, I definitely don't see.
Yeah, I think that's what you learn when you start really learning something, is that you don't know anything.
Right, exactly.
But, I mean, we still have to do the best we can just with, you know, what we can tell from our current perspective.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, you know, we've run over so many different areas here. I wonder, for this particular segment of what we're talking about, how can we, and you know, put this together in a way that makes people feel, you know, the tremendously good possibilities that are accessible right now. You don't have to be a person with just phenomenal control and discipline and, you know, all these things. Anybody can immediately start feeling better in certain ways. And you know, what are the main things they need to focus on to implement that wherever they are?
Well, one of the main things we could do is this spiritual work. It's like it's simply focusing more and making that commitment that I talked about and connecting to God or the Creator, whatever you want to, you know. Mm-hmm. And but doing the focus work. For example, that example that I gave earlier where we're sitting there miserable in our car.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we're just like, life sucks, and we're looping thoughts in our head. How can we make our life better? How can we make our life better? Mm-hmm. The next time this happens, it could almost be like a celebration. This is exciting. It's almost like you get to prove yourself. Let me give you an example. Man, you know, sometimes when you're driving, like you're hanging out all by yourself, and then all of a sudden this hazy, foggy cloud comes over your mind, over your head, and it almost just like magnetizes you into this like zone of where you just want to zone out. And if someone were to look at you right now, you'd probably look like a dead corpse.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's say you're sitting there driving, doing well, and all of a sudden this hazy, foggy thing comes over you. It almost like magnetizes you into this and pulls you into this state of misery, to where you start looping the thoughts in your mind like, oh, how can I make my life better? How can I make my life better? And because we've obeyed this magnetism for all of our lives, we feel like almost like we have to obey it. We've been obeying it for eons. And when you're being magnetized like that and you're just like zoning out in outer space, we want to try to avoid that, because this is another situation where our energy is being drained. So it's almost like we want to go against that magnetism in order not to be subject to that energy drain. So you're sitting there in your car, you've been put into the state of misery, and you're looping in your mind, and it's almost like you feel stuck. But if we start to do the focus work and be like, no, and be like, I don't accept that, and then you start doing the focus work and going against this magnetism, and you keep going and you keep going, it almost feels like pain and suffering, but you want to experience more spiritual energy. Spiritual energy is both the good and the bad. And it's almost like you have to experience it. It's almost like going against this magnetism that you've always obeyed to for so long. And then you're sitting there and it gets really, really intense, really intense. And then all of a sudden you get past it and you're like over it. And now you're not like subject to that energy drain in those loops and thoughts. And it's kind of like you did it.
Wow. So
it's, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, I'm trying to identify clearly for myself and everybody else, the pattern, the basic description of the pattern that you're saying we can change. And I think that is that we've got some habitual responses, like, for example, to those kind of negative thoughts, that we just have to give in to them. That's who we are. We just feel terrible. And so we just have to feel terrible. And, you know, until it just happens to feel better by itself and something, in quote, good happens to stop it. But we can actually have a lot more to say about how soon we start feeling better, right? Does it?
Absolutely.
Does that make
sense? Yes. It's using our greatest spiritual weapon, which is our focus work. If you're going to stare and figure out how to get out of that mess, you're trying to figure out what you can do. You're getting out of your mind. If you're in your mind, you're not even there. You're just allowing the loops out, and then your energy is being drained when you're in that state of misery. But if you start battling, you're not subject to that energy drain until you get out of it. That's like the whole, it's almost like it's that focus work is that focus is your spiritual weapon, and you can utilize it to get out much sooner. And the more you do this, the more you learn in every situation, to the point where it becomes faster and faster and faster.
Right. So you know, it reminds me of the phenomenon where maybe some people can relate to. Let's say that you're not feeling very good, your body's not even feeling very good, you're a little bit sick or tired or whatever, and you go to what is for you the most fantastic music concert or something that you are just carried away with, and it's like it's beyond some kind of a drug high, and it just, it's demonstrating that there's this super high, exhilarated, happy energy inside you, even when you physically may not feel very good. And it's not coming really from the music, that's the trigger. It's coming from inside you, which means it's always there. And if you could access that, then these physical changes like what to do with your diet and stuff like that could theoretically become easy, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, right? I think that you can obtain a state regardless of how tired you are. It's almost like a person can all of a sudden get a chip on their shoulder and be upset with someone and be angry, and they like stuck in a state or something like this. Mm-hmm. It's almost like you can maybe you're not even tired, and then you're just like saying you're tired. Yeah, it's definitely, there's something you could definitely do on a spiritual level there to lift yourself up out of there.
Yeah, I mean, just knowing that there's some kind of a super good energy just vibrating through you all the time, regardless of circumstances. If we could connect to that more, find ways to do that, like, for example, what you're saying with the, what is it, kind of a recalibration of how you're looking at what's happening inside you. If you did that, start it right away as the first thing, even before you decide what to do with your diet, the rest of it, I mean, it seems like that would give you power to change things really easily.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that that can actually help big time. It's almost like a board game, again, like I talked about before. For example, here's an example of that happened at one of my recent hangouts. A woman is fearful that she's going to have a miscarriage, and she wants to make sure she has everything possible in order, like, what supplements can she take? It's like she doesn't have trust in the process. Mm-hmm. So this can result in a miscarriage, unfortunately. So what happens is, as soon as the fear comes in, it's almost like a button's being pressed, and then you fall for it. You go into these loops in your mind, like, oh, I'm going to have a miscarriage. What can I do? It's like you're freaking out, and then you have this energy, but right now your energy is being drained. It's almost like as you do the spiritual work, all of a sudden you feel that button that was just pushed to get you to go through these loops or whatever, and then you stop it. As soon as you feel it coming in, you'd be like, no, I don't know. Like, I'm not fearful. Like, this is like the ongoing spiritual journey of what's going on.
Yeah, it's pretty exciting because, I mean, you're giving an illustration of how the thing that you worry about and fear is likely to happen because of that, right? Or more likely, anyway.
More likely, definitely. But the point of that is kind of like catching it at the very beginning so you don't end up in that state.
Yeah, because if that's the negative placebo, right, that you're giving yourself by allowing yourself to just stay in fear and worry, and so you could just as easily do the opposite and start, you know, thinking about the images that make you feel really great and make that more likely to happen the same way.
Right. Like, if you just, as soon as you get the trigger of going into fear, you got to catch it and be like, no. And it's like you start to learn the spirit. This is the focus work. We're always trying to be in the peace state or connecting and doing the work to keep these things out.
Right. And it's just that it doesn't work very well to just say, peace, I'm going to feel peaceful no matter what. You know, and you know, doing it that way is not going to have as good results as if you can put your attention on something that automatically makes you feel like that. Right?
It's like doing the focus work and learning your reality is like your chessboard game. It's everything you experience, and the goal is to dominate and be in the best state as possible. Let me just go, I'll go a little bit deeper into this right now.
Yeah.
We all have five senses. We, you know, the touch, taste, smell, sight, sound, all of that stuff. Mm-hmm. We're the one in the middle experiencing it all. And then there's other things we experience that are not our five senses, such as emotions, feelings, misery, all these other things. This is actually the sixth sense. Many people think like the sixth sense is just unfathomable to them, but we experience it all the time. It's anything that you experience that's not the fifth sense. five senses. So you're the one in the middle of all of this. You experience everything that is happening in your reality. And what we have to figure out in this chessboard game is to keep the garbage out and to be as clean, as much of a clean state as possible. We get help from the creator and things like that. Mm-hmm. And to give you an example of how the entire sixth sense thing is and how real this spiritual world is, it might even open your eyes a little bit more to the spiritual world. Let's say that you're hanging out and you're walking down the street outside and everything is extremely peaceful. Nobody's around. You feel great. You know, you're just like doing your thing. And then all of a sudden you see someone walking your way. All of a sudden that peace goes away. And all of a sudden it's almost like you're kind of like, it's like you don't feel the peace anymore. And it's like almost like you're on guard on some sort of level. And it's like as you pass this person, an entire thing is happening. It's like your state just changed. It's almost like your reality is being impacted by another reality. Something is going on here on a spiritual level. And depending on who is walking by you will determine what you experience. It's almost kind of like when someone says hello and another person says hello, one could be like a good feeling and one could be like completely different. Maybe it's a guy and you're a girl and this guy is cute and you're like, you know, kind of like vibrating magnetism to where, you know, he looks at you. Or maybe this guy's creepy and you're kind of like, you know, scared because you feel him like staring at you. And it's like, it's something is going on here on a spiritual level. And if we start to do this focus work, this realm can start to open up to us.
And you just start becoming aware of what you're actually thinking and feeling that you didn't even know you were doing before.
Yeah, kind of. And another example is, let's say you're sitting at home and then all of a sudden you start getting this pride thing coming in to where you're like, oh, this person did this, and you start hating on him or her, and it's like you're in these loop thoughts on this person. Well, guess what? That person is experiencing it. They feel it. Mm-hmm. So this, what they are feeling is something foreign to their own reality. Now, I'm not saying that humans are the only foreign thoughts that there are, because there's a lot more to it than what we think. Mm-hmm. But I'm trying to show that all thoughts are not necessarily our own.
Right. Yeah, it's a big subject. So in other words, everybody's operating on levels that they're not even aware of. And it sounds like your focus work, for one part of it, is to make more of those levels that you're functioning on conscious.
Yeah, absolutely. Become more conscious of them. And this focus work, you can start actually, this can open up to you. And the goal is to be focusing as much as possible and connecting to the creator.
Yeah, and I guess, you know, experientially, if you want to do that more and more, you have to drop a lot of preconceptions, right? So that you're not just running a loop of certain thoughts.
Absolutely. The programs, yes.
Yeah, you want to act, whatever's out there or in there, you want to actually experience it instead of just, you know, telling yourself something over and over again.
Absolutely.
Okay, so what have we not dealt with that if you happen to be talking to a few hundred thousand people at a time that you would really want to have them, you know, absorb from interaction with you that we haven't adequately looked at? Because there's probably a lot of stuff that's not even occurred to me. And you've given a lot of talks. What's important that we need to make sure that we mention or cover?
I mean, I would say probably like the main points that we've talked about during this entire talk, can be highlighted that are extremely important. For example, it's more important what you don't eat versus what you actually eat in order to heal. Okay. Processed foods is what is damaging to the human body, and it's not raw foods that heals us, but the elimination of processed foods.
Okay.
And on a spiritual level, this focus work is critical, and then just even more critical than that is what I consider, you know, connecting to God, the creator, And this focus work is like doing the work, the spiritual work, in order to grow, heal, and all that other stuff.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, one question I would like to ask you with respect to all that, since a lot of people are becoming somewhat aware that there's a lot of intentional destructive things going on, mostly at the hands of our, you know, supposed leaders in government and global corporations and things, that a lot of these poisons we have to deal with is because they're being, intentionally put there. Is what's going to happen with that continuing to go on that level of consciousness that, you know, they're working toward their goals, and the other side of the people doing the focus work and working on a completely different universe? How do you see all this, you know, working out, or do you have a feeling for that?
Well, I mean, I'm not the determiner. The creator is the determiner of it all. But the more people that make that commitment, mm-hmm. and put the effort into changing their intent and like kind of almost like vowing themselves to the creator in some sort of level, the better our chances of our experience here is my assumption. Again, I don't know what is really going on that type of level.
That, it takes a lot of wisdom to realize that we don't.
Right. And but then another thing is, like, people are always complaining about, you know, these powers that are destroying the world. These powers have always been around since caveman times. Mm-hmm. It's almost like it's always been this battle. So it's like just something to keep in mind. It's something that just came yesterday.
Right. No, it's just using different tools and approaches now, but it's the same negative intent there. And I think people who have really looked at that, one thing comes to mind. I think it was Gandhi that said it about, and it goes with what you're describing, about being whatever change you want to see happen, being it yourself.
Right. And for example, who is the determiner of evil? Like, is it man? No. If that was the case, I'd be extremely an evil person, because I've had petitions written against me for recommending animal protein to people or something like that. Seriously, or carrying an animal product on our website. It's like, they're not the determinant of evil. If they were the determinant of evil, I'd be screwed, or a lot of people would be screwed. You see what I'm saying here?
Yeah.
So a lot of the time, we don't even necessarily know what is good and what is bad. How are we supposed to be?
Right. So, except we do have the opportunity to do something with ourselves if we want to.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Well, I mean, our talk has really clarified for me why I really love all the work that you're doing, and I find it so inspirational on all these different levels. But hopefully a lot of other people will benefit from it too, and I'd like to just wrap it up by making sure people know how to find your sites, your books, your hangout, or whatever you want them to find, just so that it becomes easy and obvious.
Yeah, absolutely. My website is therawfoodworld.com. We're the largest online raw foods and superfood store in the world. Everything is available there. You could also look at my YouTube channel by going to YouTube and just typing Matt Monarch and going there, and all the replays of all the hangouts are there. And then I'm always doing videos of YouTube videos, like recipes, raw food recipes, and other talks like that. And a lot of my hangouts are geared towards raw food and the spiritual stuff.
Yeah, I found them incredibly good in all the videos. One thing I did forget to ask you about on the physical level of doing things for your health, we're all wearing patches on our skin that are kind of saturated with things that we don't really want to absorb unless we're wearing organic clothing, right? Cotton is one of the biggest GMO crops, at least in the U.S., and even the non-GMO ones, so you have lots of weed killer and stuff if they're not organic. So there are organic clothes made, right, that are actually good, and hopefully if people buy more of them, the prices might
get within reach of the average person eventually. I think your wife is doing something with this, right? Or isn't she doing something with cosmetics and clothes and stuff like that?
She's not really doing anything. She just likes to support that the industry you're talking about. We make sure to always wear that type of stuff. She talks about it on videos and things like that.
Okay. And are those in your channel too, your video channel?
My wife's channel, she's Angela Stokes. Hers is Glow with Grace.
Okay, yeah, because I found that really helpful too. And do you try to use organic clothing when you can?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm wearing bamboo right now as we speak.
Wow. Okay. I know people are visualizing these stalks of bamboo hanging around your waist.
Right.
Yeah, pretty neat. Okay, well, I would really hope that everybody goes to those sites. And I think we covered a lot. And people can replay it and listen to it. It's going to reach lots and lots of people. And
awesome.
Thank you for the time. I deeply appreciate it. Hold on for a minute, and we'll say goodbye at the break. Okay, so there goes Matt Monarch, and very in-depth, detailed discussion of things that he teaches about healing with food and with attitude and with focus work, spiritual focus, and also just general lifestyle issues, and the fact that he's using the cooked whole foods with people instead of just exclusively raw food, and has gotten incredible results. So again, check out all of his extensive videos on YouTube as well as his site, therawfoodworld.com. And I wanted to say a couple of things also in respect to our talk with David tonight. That really illustrated to me the choice that we have to make in how we respond to what our rulers are doing. We talked about this, mentioned it at the very end of Matt's talk also, what the negative programs are moving against humanity, and in so many different ways with all the issues, separate issues that we mentioned before, that to me are all part of one issue. And what they want us to do in response to this attack on humanity, made up of all these multiple attacks actually, is to stop free speech, to stop expressing anything that might be distasteful to the rulers, and definitely don't do anything that's outside of what's acceptable. And I was really thinking about that a lot this week as we did the project with David and learning about all these doctors that were being killed. I don't think receding away from this and being quiet and just being subservient as we get run over is really the best thing. I said before, I don't think we need to use force and violence against these programs. I think that would be entirely counterproductive to use anything preemptive like that. But as far as what we should do, I think we need to put more energy into bringing the positive side forward instead of just cringing in front of all of these negative things. So I was looking at how that affects the radio program and Lost Arts Research Institute, which was started at the same time for a different purpose, but connected. And I decided, all right, well, you know, I have a natural tendency to want to be invisible and just work privately. I like seclusion and nature and harmony, not a lot of public exposure, and high profile things don't appeal to me at all. But I thought, under the circumstances, since we're doing this at all and we're trying to spread information that would help with people's real education and give them tools that they can use to be healthy and get stronger internally, why don't we just rev that up and take it to the next level? Lost Arts Radio is not generating any money. In fact, it can only keep going if there's some kind of revenue stream connected with it, and we don't have one at all right now. The advertising that I accept, a lot of it, most of it is all free, because it's things that I go to the advertiser and say, your stuff is so good, we want to carry banners or advertising without charging you, just to let our listener know that this is something that we think is good. That doesn't make very much money. In fact, none. And on Lost Arts Research Institute, there's also none there yet. But the purpose of starting Lost Arts Research Institute was to construct an actual facility where all of these principles that we're gradually getting into here about natural ways to get over health problems, clarify your mind, get over emotional chaos and things like that and become very strong and get back in touch with normal levels of energy, which are high and healthy and happy. And we're not supposed to know about how to do it because it would ruin the drug industry. I decided I'm going to go ahead, and if there's support for this kind of thing and people believe in it and they want to see it happen, I've already got sites that could be picked out to start putting this project together physically. And I want to see if there is support. I don't want financial support from anybody that's struggling to get by, and most people are right now. But anyone that has resources and wants to support this happening faster, the creation of a physical facility where these natural means of extremely high health, high energy, staying in great condition until you die, which I already know from the last 50 years of work that this is our normal state. Please consider considering consider supporting our efforts at the new crowdfunding site, which is gofundme.com/lostarts. This will keep the radio program on the air without doing anything else that would compromise the intent of the show. And besides keeping the radio program going, it would also help us toward the giant project of creating this facility where people can learn information that would help them get over diseases and in ways that are actually beneficial for their bodies, minds, emotions, and spirit that have always been available. And that's why on our site is the Essene Gospel of Peace, both written in PDF form and a link that you can go and see that these principles of natural health and healing have been taught for thousands of years and more. I mean, it's nothing new. It's just supposed to be a big secret now. And part of our mission is to make it not be a big secret anymore. I've done enough personally with these things now that we could be demonstrating what happens with all these conditions, not by doing it ourselves, because that's not legal in America, but giving people the information to do it themselves in a supportive environment that's all geared toward what our natural state really is. And I have enough detailed plans now that could be started tomorrow if the funding is there. We can't use venture capitalists because I've met and worked with too many of them that would ruin this in a second because the purity of intent is not there. This can't be run just as something to generate the maximum money. It has to be done to help humanity. And that's what we're after. So visit the site, GoFundMe/LostArts, GoFundMe.com/LostArts. Let me know what you think about it. I'm open to comments anytime. We've got some more incredible guests coming up next week. And I'm not going to tell you quite yet who they are, but it's going to be exciting. And in the meantime, with the first part of this show, and actually with the whole thing, spread it as far as you can. If Matt gives somebody encouragement to get through their addictions and make themselves healthy without drugs or having their organs cut out or the usual therapies that are recommended nowadays, that would be helpful. And spreading it for the sake of David Noakes, who was brave enough to do the interview at the first part of this show, the wider it gets spread and the quicker that's done, the more security and safety for everybody involved. So let's see, what else can I tell you? Anyway, I guess that's the main thing is, for me, it's a personal decision that if the support among our listeners and followers is there, I want to make this project happen quickly just to help make your life the absolute best it can possibly be in spite of the environment that we're all living in and turn it into something really wonderful. So thanks for being here. I really appreciate your help and participation, and I'll see you next week. Have a great week.
I am hearing you above the noise. Above the turn noise. And run to you. I have no choice. I'm choosing to trust in love over logic, following the sound of your voice. Yes, I am hearing you above the din.